More work for The Undertaker. In a masterpiece of storytelling, Marjorie Allingham sends her elegant and engaging detective Albert Campion into the eccentric Palinode household, where there have been two suspicious deaths. And if poisoning were not enough, there are also anonymous letters, sudden violence, and a vanishing coffin. Meanwhile, the Palinodes go about their nocturnal business and Campion dices with danger in his efforts to find the truth.
And now, our Murder for Christmas play. We present More Work for the Undertaker by Marjorie Allingham, dramatised for radio by Margaret Eatall, with Francis Matthews as Albert Campion, Geoffrey Matthews as Lug, and Tim Meats as Detective Inspector Luke. The setting for More Work for the Undertaker is London, 1946.
Lug, put out my tails, will you?
Going it a bit, aren't we, now we're back from the wars?
Yes.
Who's a lucky party this time?
Just do it, Lug.
All right, cop, keep your hair on. Why, we are short today. Did you have a nice time with Mr. Roadston?
Oh, very pleasant. We sat in the park.
Oh, very healthful.
Yeah, very. We watched a charming old lady in a motoring veil and six different dresses and grass in her shoes receive sixpence from a passing do-gooder. Apparently a daily occurrence.
A simple mendicant. Blimey. Don't they give Oatsy boy anything to do at the yard now he runs the place?
Ah, the sister of the lady in the park died recently.
What's that got to do with us?
Well, she may have been helped on her way. Poisoned.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, Oates has put Superintendent Yeo onto it, and Yeo wants me to make a few discreet inquiries.
Oh, was he there too? Chief Busybody's get-together, was it?
Hmm.
Thought he was giving all that up and going to be respectable. A government island. Oh, I've got me advert written out.
Got your what?
My advert. Gentleman's gentleman seeks interesting employment. Remarkable references. Title preferred.
I see.
Yeah, well, that's about it. I can't come with you, cock. I don't want to see myself an international incident. Yeah. But can't you oblige the Chief Justice once?
No, I fear not, no. But it is interesting.
Mm.
It's the Palinode family are relics of a gracious past. They're odd and brainy. But not the sort who get poisoned.
Well, could happen to anybody.
Yes, well, they'll know soon enough. They're digging the poor sister up again, Miss Ruth Palinode.
Tickles your fancy, doesn't it? Can't resist it.
As a matter of fact, Renee Roper has asked me to go and stay for a bit.
Well, that nice old stage lady.
Mm.
How does she fit in?
Well, she apparently now owns the house where all the Palinode tribe live.
Mm-hmm.
Well, those are the left, anyway. So she's naturally very concerned.
Yeah, what a coincidence. Must be an omen.
No, two crows don't make a summons, Lug. You need three for that.
Move your arm.
What's the time?
Hmm?
I've got to ring Lord Dodaway before five.
Oh, so it's final, then. You're going to accept.
Yes, I am.
Yeah, better tell the lady wife, then. Lady Amanda rang up and asked, but I said I didn't know.
What's this?
Hmm?
Courtesy, sympathy, comfort in transit. Jazz Bowles and Son, the Practical Undertakers, 12 Apron Street, West 3. Apron Street is where the Palinodes live.
That is a private letter, that is.
Mm.
Oh, well, go on, read it if you like.
To Mr. Magus Fontaine Lug, Esquire, care of A. Campion, Esquire, 12A Bottle Street, Piccadilly, Westmont. Dear Magus, if Beattie was alive, which she is not, more's the pity, she would be writing this instead of me and the boy.
We was wondering this dinner time. Can you get your governor to give us a bit of a hand in this Palinode kick-up, which you may have read of in the papers? Exhumations, as we call them in the trade, are not very nice and bad for business. Without disrespect, bring him along for a bit of tea and a jaw any day, as we do not do much after 3:30, and we'll do less if this goes on. Remembering you very kindly, and all forgotten.
All forgotten, I hope. Yours truly, Jas Bowles.
Amazing cheek, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, he's a horrible man.
Seems to know you pretty well.
He's my brother-in-law. Married my only sister, the poor worm shoveler.
I see.
Yeah, during the war, that was the first war, I mean. Haven't spoken to him for 30 years. Come my little trip inside, he behaved as though I took him with me.
sent back me wedding present to Bean.
And I wrote him clean off me slate.
Now he pops up out of the past and asks a favour when I couldn't help him if I could bring myself to it.
Is this a put-up job?
Some remarks I do not hear.
Yes, when exactly did this arrive?
10 minutes ago, late post. No need to get excited. What's jazz to you, anyway?
The third crow, it seems.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
Shall I get his lordship for you?
No. Get me Chief Superintendent Yeo.
DDI Charlie Luke, sir. Superintendent Yale said I'd find you here. I'm glad to see you.
I hope it's not as bad as that.
That's our ration. 4 doubles each.
Oh, good.
Marchab looks after us here at the plate layers, but she says it'll have to last the night. It's gold dust these days.
It's very generous.
Tell me, how many palinode murders have you actually got on your hands?
Don't know of any for certain. Mm. Not yet. I don't know what you've heard so far, but I'll rough it in as it's come to me. It began with Dr. Smith, a tallish old boy married to a shrew. Starts getting poison pen letters.
Oh, yeah.
I'll show you the filth later. Mm. But chiefly, accuse him of conniving at murder. Old lady called Ruth Palinode murdered, buried, no questions asked. Doc to blame. Doc gets wind up slowly. Bill's patients may be getting the same letters. I'm called in. Now we go to Apron Street.
That's the Palinode house, is it?
No, not yet. No. Street important. Mm. Narrow little way. Old Brotherhood Chapel, now the Thespis Rep Theatre. Highbrow, harmless, one end. Portminster Lodge, the Palinode house, the other. The district's gone down like a drunk in 30 years, and the Palinode's with it. Now, a dear old variety gal turned lodging house keeper owns their house. Mortgage fell in. She inherited. Her own place got blitzed. So she moved over with some of her old boarders and took the Palinode family in her stride.
Well, Miss Rope is an old acquaintance of mine. She did me a very good turn back in 36 when I was having a bit of bother with some ballet stars.
Did she, though? Then you can tell me something. Could she have written the letters?
Well, I don't know sufficiently well to say. I should have guessed she was the last person in the world not to have signed her name.
Oh, so should I. I love her. We're going on the halls, we are. But you never know, do you?
Anyone else?
Who might have written them? Hmm. About 500. Any one of the Doc's patients. I'll drink up, sir. And I'll give you the smell of the street.
Ah.
Lots of small shops. Family businesses. Have known the Palinodes forever. On good terms with Reenie. One of them's a chemist. Oh, what an emporium. Great jars of coloured water in the window. Dozens of little drawers of muck. Smell of old lady's bedroom enough to knock you back. And old Pa Wilde in the middle of it looking like Auntie's ruin with his dyed hair and little black tie. When old Joey and Pantaloon Bowles dug up Miss Ruth Palinode, I must say I started thinking about Pa Wilde. I don't mean he administered whatever it was. But I bet it came from there.
When do you expect the analyst report?
Midnight. Hmm. If it's something that could only have been criminally administered, we wake up the undertakers and dig up the brother right away.
Well, that's the eldest brother, I take it.
Yes. Edward Palinode, aged 67 at the time of his decease 7 months ago.
Hmm. So, what is there after the chemist?
Opposite the chemist, Pa Wilde, there's only that old blighter Bowles. The bank, the entrance to the Mews, which goes down to Barrow Road, and the worst pub in the world, the Footman. Portminster Lodge is on the corner, same side as the chemist's. Enormous. Basement kitchen where Reenie entertains her chums. Palinode's as boarders, and one or two others. Old variety turn called Clary Grace, just out of the RAF. And a Captain Seaton. Oh, look through there.
Hmm?
He's in the bar now. Having his weekly half pint.
Oh, yeah.
Soldierly party over in the corner.
Quite the dandy, is he?
Yes. Lives on next to nothing, but keeps up appearances. He was Reenie's pet boarder in her other house, so she brought him with her. He's one of the better rooms now. I think in a funny way he's enjoying all this. Bit of excitement, you see.
Why don't you want to talk about the Palinodes, Inspector?
Can't.
Why?
Don't understand them.
How do you mean?
Just that. I don't understand what they say.
Long words?
Not particularly. But when I read the verbatim reports, I keep sending for the stenographer to see if he's got the words right. He doesn't know either.
I see.
There's three of them left, I can tell you that. Mr. Lawrence, Miss Evadne, and the baby, Miss Jessica. She's the girl with the concertina stockings who gets presents in the park. She does crosswords in Latin. I've seen them. They're not balmy, any of them. God knows why anyone should kill them. I gather you're moving in, sir.
At once, I thought. I brought a bag with me. Reenie's passing me off as her nephew.
It's good news to me. Sorry I can't give you a line on these people, Mr. Kempion. But they're old-fashioned and out of the ordinary. I've got the stage where as soon as I think of them, I feel a bit faint. I'll send you word of the analyst report as soon as I get it.
Right, thank you.
Oh!
Who is it? Oh, it's you, Ducky.
Yeah.
Oh, come in, dude.
Right.
There. Oh, this is good of you. I appreciate it and I shan't forget it.
Oh.
Now, how's your mother? Nicely?
As well as can be expected. Aunt Renee.
Oh. But I know well. We mustn't grumble. Now, come along to the kitchen, dear. Clary, I don't think you've met my nephew. Albert. He's the one from Berry. The knobby side of the family, dear. He's a lawyer. And one does so need one at a time like this.
I'm glad to be here, Auntie.
Pleased to meet you. My name's Grace. Clarence Grace. Oh. I don't suppose you've heard of it.
Now sit down, Ducky. I expect you're hungry and I'll find you something.
Oh, thank you, Auntie. I've already eaten.
Oh. Are you sure?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I had something on the train.
Oh, well, that's a mercy anyway. Have a drop of Clary Stout then, dear, while I get on with your bed. It's quite a nice room and no one's died in it. In my time, at any rate, so you needn't be nervous.
Have some beer.
Oh, thank you.
You know, Renie's been a pal of mine ever since I was a nipper. And somehow, I can't see you being her nephew. I should have heard of you before. I must have. She's one of the very best, Renie is. Your old man wasn't really her brother, was he?
Only in a manner of speaking.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's rich. That's Wizzo. I shall use that. You're a laugh, you are. You're going to cheer us up. Here, keep up your strength. They can't get at the bottle stuff.
Who?
The family. The Palliali's upstairs. Roll me over. You don't think Irene or I or even Captain, excuse my glove, have been going in for chemistry, do you? We're all right. We've known each other for donkey's years. It's the Palliali's, that's certain. But they can't get at the beer. Check the seals myself.
I should hardly think you were all in much danger of indiscriminate poisoning. I mean, it's not as if any further attempt has been made.
My dear old boy, you're a lawyer. You don't see the situation in a human light. Of course we're all in danger. There's a killer about, isn't there? Besides, what about the brother, the first one? He died, didn't he, last March? The police will be having him up next. They're all in it together. That's my theory.
Well, I realize they're eccentric.
Eccentric? Oh, good Lord, no. They're all number eight hats and very quite. Their old man was a sort of genial, sir, a professor. Letters after his name. Old Miss Ruth wasn't up to the family standard. She was going a bit. Used to forget her own name and take her plate out in public and that sort of thing generally. Thought she was invisible, probably. I think the others just got together and talked it over and she couldn't make the grade.
Where could I meet one of them?
Well, you could go up now, Ducky, if you cared to. Take that tray up to Miss Evadne for me. Somebody's got to do it.
Dear me.
What a collection.
Oh, never you mind. That's what she has. There you are. First floor, third door on the left.
Right.
Clary, you can do Mr. Lawrence tonight. Take him a kettle and he can mix it himself.
Right.
Come in. Do come in. I'm just going. I'll let myself out, Miss Pellinard.
Put it here, on this little table. And be careful of those glasses, if you please. They're very rare. Haired groom, what gars thy pipe so loud? Why bidden thy looks so snicker and so proud? Perdy plain peers, but this couth ill agree with thick bad fortune, which I thwarteth thee.
Hmm. That thwarteth me, good Palinode, is fate. Eborn was peers to be unfortunate.
Infortunate. So, you're an actor, of course. I ought to have known. Miss Roper has so many friends from the stage. Tell me, out of a shop.
I'm afraid I haven't acted for some considerable time.
Oh, never mind. We must see what we can do. Now, let me see what you've brought me. Oh, yes. Splendid. Now, tip the egg into the slip, right?
In?
Yes, go on, straight in. Stir as you go. Don't spill it. I dislike dirty saucer. Now the sugar. That's quite right. Hand the cup to me and keep the spoon, for if you've mixed it rightly, I shall not need it. Yes, that's very nicely done.
Good.
I think I must ask you to my theatrical afternoon next Tuesday. You would like to come, of course. It might lead to something, but I can't promise. The repertory theatre is overcrowded this year, but I'm afraid you know that.
I believe it is a small theatre near here, isn't it?
Indeed, there is. The Thespis. Very hard-working little troupe. Some of them are quite talented, and once a month they all come here to a little conversazione, and we have some amusing talk. I did wonder if perhaps I should put it off next week. We've had a little awkwardness in the house. Expect you've heard of it.
Mm.
But on the whole, I think I shall carry on as usual. The only difficulty is those wretched newspaper men. Although, in fact, they bother my brother far more than they do me.
Yes, I think I saw your brother as I came in.
Oh, no. No, that was not Lawrence. Lawrence is a rather different person.
Oh.
That was little Mr. James, our bank manager. I always get him to come over when I have any business. It's very little trouble for him. When you came in, I wondered if you were one of the reporters, but as soon as you capped my little piece of peel, I knew I was wrong.
I've got this thing for you. I worked it out in Ruff's Guide to the Turf, but I've mislaid it.
Well, have you corn-throat?
Well, of course I have. As I've always said, the foreign wheat was completely witless. What she was doing was dangerous.
Does it matter now, after all the sheaves of alien corn are gathered?
Yeah, all the same, I had to test it. You must see that I am right. Oh, good evening to you.
Good evening,
That was my brother, Lawrence.
Oh.
He is extremely clever. Of its kind, a most ingenious mind. He prepares all the crossword puzzles for the Literary Weekly in his spare time.
Ah.
Although his real work is on the origins of Arthur. He has so many subjects.
Including horse racing, no doubt.
Horse racing? Oh, yes. But only on paper.
What does corn throat mean?
Oh, to search, simply.
Ah.
A family reference. You may take the tray now.
Oh, thank you. Good evening, Miss Palinode. What?
There's a light switch by your side, Ducky.
Oh, just
here, I've got a letter for you.
Oh, really? Thank you. Oh. Dear sir, Re-Ruth Palino deceased. Analysts report to hand, 030 hours this morning.
Organs contain 2/3 grain hyoscine in available material, indicating much larger dose. Probably administered in form hyoscine hydrobromide, but no evidence to show if taken subcutaneously or by mouth. Normal medicinal dose, 1/100th to 1/50th grain. Re Edward von Creighton Palino deceased. Proposed to have up, pronto. Belvedere Cemetery, Wilswich, huh?
4 a.m. approximately. Cordial invitation extended. No offense taken if you cut it. See Luke DDI. Well, now, what's this for? Steady my nerves. Must I?
Oh, the whiskey's all right. Take my dying oath, it is. I've had it under lock and key.
Did the policeman wake you?
Oh.
I'm so sorry. There was no great urgency.
No, I was about, you know. Well, I got used to pottering around at night during the war. The air raid wardens were always popping in. I want to talk to you, Mr. Campion.
Yeah.
First of all, I want just to tell you this. I'm absolutely on the level with you. I'm more than grateful to you, and you really can trust me. I shan't keep anything back, and I mean that, see?
What's on your conscience, Auntie?
Well, there's one little thing that's been going on for a long time, and I feel I ought to mention it, dear, just so that you don't go rooting it out and being surprised. Hello?
I do beg your pardons.
Oh.
I was passing the door and thought the room was unoccupied. My attention was caught by the shaft of light.
Oh, go along with you. You smelt it. Come along. There's a tooth glass over there. Bring it here. Here. There. This is Captain Seaton, Albert.
Oh, hello.
Now, it's quite a good thing you've come, because you can tell Mr. Campion exactly how it was that Miss Ruth was taken ill.
I didn't kill the lady. On the contrary, I did what I could. I found her in the hall at 12:30. There she was, crimson in the face, and shouting out what sounded like a lot of figures. But she couldn't articulate properly. So I knew she was ill, not just mad.
Well, the doctor told me ages ago her blood pressure nearly broke his instrument.
Got her to her room, sat her in the only chair free of books, and covered her over. And went for the Sawbones next door. He was just off to officiate at a birth of some sort, and said he'd come back when he could. I came back and took another look at her, and she seemed to have gone to sleep.
That's right, dear. When I looked in about 2, she was breathing rather heavily, but I thought we'd better leave her till the doctor came.
When was that?
Nearly 3.
Uh-huh.
And she was dead by then.
He said he had thrombosis. He was expecting it. I couldn't blame him.
Yet someone did.
Oh, people will talk. Any sudden death makes a lot of stink.
At any rate, I did not kill the vulgar trollop. I had words with her, I admit it, and I still feel I was within my rights. But once and for all, I did not kill her!
Oh, shush! Don't wake the house, dear.
Good night. Many thanks.
Good night.
Go there, silly old fool. Now all that'll have to come out, I suppose. It's only because of the room. Old people are like children, they get jealous. I gave him a nice room when we came here, and Ruth always wanted it. She said she'd had it as a child, and when she found she couldn't get any change out of me, she had to go at him. That's all there was to it, really. I'm not lying, Ducky. No, he was too footling to mention.
Was that the awful secret you were going to uncover?
What? Me and the captain?
Yes.
My dear, we've lived in the same house for nearly 30 years. You don't want a detective to find out any secret there. You want a time machine. No. Now, I was going to tell you about the coffin cupboard.
I beg your pardon?
Well, of course it may not be coffins. Well, I've never seen inside.
Suppose you tell me what you're talking about.
Well, I've let one of my cellars, Ducky, the little ones leading off the area around by the front door. I'm not actually in the house at all. To old Mr. Bowles, the undertaker.
What?
Well, he asked me as a special favour, and I didn't like to refuse him.
When was this?
Oh, years ago. Well, months anyway. He's always very quiet, but, well, I thought you might possibly hear him and his son down there tonight and wonder what it was.
Is he here?
Well, if he isn't, he soon will be. He popped in when you was up with Miss Evadne to say I wasn't to be nervous if I heard him moving about between 3 and 4.
Nobody will be at... Oh, no, of course. They didn't bury him.
Mr. Edward? No, Bowles and son didn't know. Oh, there was a fuss about that. Mr. Edward had it put in his will, the thoughtless old man. Oh, he was full of smarty ideas. He lost the family their money, being so clever. Well, there you are, my dear.
Yeah.
Now, if you hear any thumping, it's just the undertaker.
Oh, the ultimate reassurance.
Oh, are we going to have a look? Oh, I've never liked to spy on him. It's 3 or 4 months since he came last.
Lead the way.
Is that them? This way. We'll go in the drawing room. There's a window there just above the cellar steps. Keep close to me.
Good heavens. Whatever is that smell?
Oh, that's all right. That's nothing. In here. Can you hear them now?
Yeah.
Shine your torch, ducky. You'll see better. Oh! Oh!
Edward von Cretan Palinode, born September the 4th, 1878, died March the 2nd, 1946.
Mr. Edward's coffin.
Yes.
Oh, how can it be?
Good evening, sir. We did not disturb you, I hope.
Oh, think nothing of it. Wait there a moment. I want a word with you.
What are you doing? Stock taking?
Not exactly, sir, not exactly, although there are likenesses. It is Mr. Campion I'm addressing, isn't it?
That's right.
I'm Jazz Bowles, at your service any time of the night or day, and this is my son, Roly Boy.
Here, Dad.
I'm just taking this casket across. We hire the cellar, you see, sir, and I've had the casket in there a month or so while we was full up over the road. Now I thought, what with one thing and another, the police and that, I'd better get her back home.
She looks a very fine affair.
Oh, she is, sir, a very special job, one of our deluxe types. A casket like that would be a credit to anybody.
Yet the man whose address is on the label had other views?
Aha, you saw it, sir. I'm caught, and I may as well admit it. He saw your nameplate, Roly Boy. He's very fly, is Mr. Campion. I ought to have known that from all I've heard from your Uncle Maggers. Yes. Vanity, Mr. C. That's what that there nameplate shows you, the vanity of Jazz Bowles. There was a gentleman in this house once that me and the boy took a real fancy to. Am I right, Roly?
As you say, Dad.
Mr. Edward Palinode. A lovely name for a headstone.
You're trying to tell me you made it on speculation, I take it.
Ah. I see we can talk, you and me, sir. I've had old Maggers all the evening, and I thought, well, anyone who employs you must know what's what, I thought. But I wasn't sure, you see. Yes, of course. I made it on Apro, and the perishing old blighter wouldn't have it. Matter of fact, I made it to fit myself. He was no bigger than what I am. She's a lovely job. Solid oak, veneered ebony. If you'll come over to the shop in the morning, sir, I'll show her to you in the light.
It wouldn't take me a moment to come down now.
No, we won't impose on you, sir. Take her along, boy.
What, Dad?
We've got to get her across the road while it's dark, sir, if you'll excuse us.
Is Lug with you?
He's in bed, sir. Good night, sir. We feel it's an honour to have met you. See you in the morning, I hope. Good night, sir. Yes, that's it, brother. Now,
he's a very good man. He's thought very highly of in the street. But I never feel I can get to the bottom of him.
I wonder what he's got at the bottom of the coffin.
Oh, well, but it was empty. There wasn't a body in it.
Well, wasn't there? Perhaps just a little foreign body?
Oh...
And now, Auntie, since we appear to have overcome any initial shyness and we can speak from the heart, the stink coming up from your basement can no longer be ignored. Come on, darling, tell me the truth. What's cooking?
Oh, get along with you.
It's only old Miss Jessica. It pleases her and it doesn't hurt anybody else. But I won't have it in the daytime because she gets in the way and, yes, there really is an awful smell. It's worse than usual tonight.
Whew. I've got a fine old menagerie here, haven't you? What's she doing?
Oh, making little mucks, dear. I don't think they're quite medicine, but she lives on them.
Eh?
Oh, don't you be silly, dear. Now you're making me feel quite jumpy. We've had our bit of excitement for tonight.
Where is she? May I go and see her?
Oh, my dear, you can do what you like. I told you that. She's quite harmless and the cleverest of the three in one way. At least she can look after herself. Go on, you go down. Just follow your nose.
All right, go and get your beauty sleep.
Oh, I need it, do I? Oh, you're laughing. Oh, you are a naughty boy.
I'm staying here. I smelled something, so I came down.
No one warned you, I suppose. The inefficiency in this house is quite extraordinary. Well, never mind. I'm sorry you were disturbed. Now you know what it is, you can go back to bed.
Oh, I don't think I shall rest. Can I help?
No, I don't think so. It's not very difficult, and as a recreation, I find it amusing, even. People make a drudgery of feeding themselves. That's very ridiculous. I make it a relaxation, and I get on very well.
I see you do. You're very alert. That doesn't suggest improper food.
That's very true. Now, would you like a nice cup of nettle tea? It's quite as nice as yerba mate and very good for one as well.
Well, thank you.
Good.
I don't quite understand, though. What are you doing?
Cooking. It may seem peculiar to you that I have to do it in the middle of the night in my own home, but there's an excellent explanation for that. Have you heard of a man called Herbert Boone?
No.
There you are, you see. Hardly anybody has. He wrote a book called How to Live on 1 and 6. Now, this was written in 1917, of course, nearly 30 years ago. Since then, the index figure has risen by approximately 40%, so we must translate that as roughly 2 and a penny. Still sounds miraculous, doesn't it?
It does indeed. Do you do it?
Live on 2 and a penny?
Yes.
Oh, I do, nearly. I'll lend you the book. It answers such a lot of people's problems.
I should think it might. Dear me, yes. Now, what's in there, may I ask?
Hmm? Oh, in this tin? Well, the thing that's been smelling, rather, is over there. It's embrocation for the grocer's knee. But this is broth for the sheep's jawbone. Not the whole head. That's too expensive. But cooked with herbs, it does very well.
Look, is this really necessary?
Do you mean, am I so poor that I have to live like this? Or are you merely inquiring if I'm mad?
No, I'm sorry. I don't really understand at all.
I have less money than the others, not because I'm the youngest, but because I trusted my elder brother to invest the greater part of my inheritance. He was a man of ideas, but he was not very practical. Mm-hmm. He lost all our money. I will not tell you my exact weekly income now, but it is counted in shillings and not in pounds.
Oh, this is the tea, is it? Where do you get the nettles?
Hyde Park. There are lots of weeds. I mean, herbs there, if one hunts for them. I made a mistake or two at first. You have to be exact, you know, with plants. And I was quite ill several times, but I've mastered it now, I think. Taste it, and if you can't bear it, I shall understand. But you must read the book.
Oh.
Lawrence doesn't like it either, but he drinks it. And he drinks this yarrow tea I make. He's very interested, but he's more conventional than I am. He doesn't really approve of my having no use for money. Although I don't know what he'd do if I had. But he has none. Is all this helping you, do you think, to find out who poisoned my sister Ruth?
How did...
I know who you are. You're a detective.
Oh.
I saw you with the other policeman in the park today.
You well, must know.
But I don't. I have no idea. I may as well admit I'm not ungrateful to whoever it was. You'll find that out, so I might as well tell you.
She was very trying, was she?
Well, not very. I hardly saw her, but I had cause to fear her. You see, the Palinode family is in the position of the crew of a small boat. If one member drinks all his allotted share of water, the rest must either watch him die of thirst or share. And we haven't very much to share, even with the assistance of Herbert Boone.
Is that all you're going to tell me?
Yes. The rest you can find for yourself. It's not very interesting.
But why? Why?
I have no gifts. I cannot make, or write, or even tell. So, I keep busy. You wouldn't like any more of that tea, I suppose.
Morning, sir.
What? Oh, morning, Luke. Of course.
Rainey sent you tea, so I begged a cup for myself.
Oh, thanks very much.
Officially, I'm interviewing her lawyer nephew. I don't suppose that tale's going to wear, but I suppose we may as well stick to it as long as we can.
Yes. Mr. Jessica spotted me as a snoop. She saw me with Oates and Yeo in the park.
Did she? Mm. Oh, they're not balmy, any of them. Now then, sir, what are the chances of Pa Wild the chemist having a basin full of hyoscine hydrobromide in his locker?
Oh, small. Now, my impression is that it's rarely used in medicine. Of course, it earned its reputation as a poison when Crippen tried it on Belle Elmore.
What is it?
Henbane, I think.
Really? What, the weed?
Yes, I think so. It's very common.
It grows everywhere. Damn it, you could find it in the park.
Yes, I suppose you could.
But then you'd have to make the muck. I'd better try the dock. And then I must tackle the bank manager.
Ah, I saw him briefly last night. He'd been to see Mr. Vadney. Neat little soul.
That's him. Mr. Henry James. Why does that name sound familiar? Refuses to talk about clients' finances unless subpoenaed.
Miss Ruth was spending too much before she was killed. I've got that far. Of course, Yeo says money is the only respectable motive for murder.
Well, none of these old dears has got any. They pay Rini peanuts, just 2 or 3 quid a week. Mm. And Jessica only pays 5 bob.
What?
5 shillings. Well, she won't eat a thing except her own boiled muck. I don't know how Rini does it, but she's got money. A lot of money. I hope she's not in something with Jas Bowles. That would destroy my faith in women, that would.
Oh, no, I hardly think so, no. I mean, would she have dragged me down in the middle of the night to catch him if she were?
That's right. Well, shall we see the bank manager? I'd like to get there about 10 o'clock.
All right.
Oh, by the way, This came over the blower last night. Housebreaker called Lukey Jeffries in Charlesfield Prison Infirmary. Delirious.
But what on earth is
Keeps
that?
Whispering, Apron Street. Don't send me up Apron Street. When he's lucid, he says he's never heard of the place.
Hmm. Do I take it he's frightened?
Seems so. But there's a note at the end. Physician reports sweating and deep agitation.
Just like old Bowles last night. He was sweating too. Look, I'll get up.
Dear me, this is very awkward. I told you, Inspector, the bank can give no information whatever, save under subpoena. And I hope to goodness it isn't going to come to that. I really do.
Could you consider forgetting the bank for a moment? You know the Palinode family in a private capacity, don't you?
Yes, I suppose I do.
We'll avoid the subject of money, then. Any good?
We'll have to. What do you want to know?
It's only routine. Miss Ruth Palinode was murdered.
Is that official?
Yes, but don't publish it before the inquest is resumed and over. We're the police, you know.
You want to know how well I knew her and when I last saw her. Is that it? Well, I've known her since I was a boy, and I last saw her one morning in the week she died. I've been trying to remember which, and I think it was the morning before the day she was taken ill. She came in here.
On business?
Yes.
She had an account here?
Not at that time.
Then her account had been recently closed.
How can I answer that?
Dong. Now, let's get back to when you were a child. Where did you live then?
Here.
In this house?
Oh, yes. There are living quarters over these offices. My father was the manager at that time. In due course, I went into the head office in the city, and finally, when my father died, I came here as manager. We're not a large concern as banks go, and we specialize in personal service. Most of our clients have been with us for generations.
Are there many other branches?
5 only. The head office is in Butler Market.
I expect you remember the Palinode family in its great days.
Oh, I do. 35 years ago, Before the Great War, this whole street was lined with carriages. The whole district used to revolve round the Palinodes. It was a great time, and they were very great people. The furs in church, the diamonds when Mrs. Palinode went to the theatre, the Christmas parties for those of us who were lucky enough to attend. When I came back and found them as they are now, it was a shock, a genuine shock.
They're still very charming people.
Oh, yes. One still feels a duty to them. But, my dear sir, then...
Perhaps Sir Edward Palinode was not the businessman his father was?
No.
Miss Jessica tells me that her weekly income is measured in shillings.
Miss Jessica? I cannot discuss that.
No, of course not. When you saw Miss Ruth last, the day before she died, she was quite well then, was she?
Oh, on the contrary. I thought she might be very ill. She was excitable, you know, very overbearing and extravagant in her demands. In fact, when I heard next day... Yes, I'm certain it was the next day that she'd had a stroke. I wasn't at all surprised.
So you accepted the diagnosis without question?
I did, I'm afraid, absolutely. I said, well, I'm not astonished. There's one weight off the shoulders of those poor people. I should never have seen you, I knew it.
There's a person to see the inspector. We don't want him in the front office, Mr. James. I send him out again. It's a detective. He wants you with the Mews, sir.
Very well. Congreve, when did Miss Ruth Palinode last call on us? The day before she died, was it not?
No. It was the same day.
No. I'm sure it was the day before. Thank you, Congreve. That will be all.
What's going on out there? It's our right hand neighbour, Mr. Bowles. Now, what's he been up to, eh?
Perhaps he's gone up Apron Street.
Well, he can't do that, sir, because this is Apron Street. You must be a stranger if you don't know that.
I'll see you out, Mr. Cabin. I'm afraid old Congreve's hearing varies. He has been with us a great many years and has certain privileges, or thinks he has. I tell you, even money isn't what it used to be. That's pure heresy, but sometimes I believe it. Good morning.
Where is it, Dice?
It's not here, Mr. Luke. Go on, Mr. Bowles, tell us again. Where is the coffin you fetched out of the cellar at Portminster Lodge last night?
At number 59 Lansbury Terrace, where we're just off to now. If I'd only known you wanted to see it, Mr. Luke, I'd have cut off my right hand rather than have used it. I'd have been obliged to oblige you. I would, really.
Beautiful nature you've got, Bowles. The body is actually in it, is it? All the relatives standing round it at this very moment, I suppose.
He happened to need it this morning. It happened to fit. He happened to have an accident with the one he made for a customer. He happened not to know we might be interested.
You put the words in me mouth, Sergeant.
We'll just take one more look round the house, if it's not inconveniencing you.
No, that is a pity. I can't manage it, Mr. Luke. Not unless we go down Lansbury Terrace at a gallop, and that might be misunderstood and cause bad feeling. But as luck will have it, I've got my brother-in-law in the kitchen. He's sitting over the fire with an heavy head. He'll be pleased to show you around and be a witness.
Very well, we'll do that. See you after the party, Bowles.
You didn't ought to joke, Mr. Luke. Not on this subject.
Ah, my dear Inspector. Welcome to our humble kitchen. I saw you chatting among the crows, so I wandered round the front and through the shop. Lug says they handed him a Mickey Finn last night.
Oh.
What did they dilute it with?
A Guinness and two halves of bitter, I ask you. Me. I went off. Like one of me brother-in-law's customers. Now, I feel like one. That's typical of Jas. Absolutely tip. In his own house. Yeah. Well, there's nothing here. I've staggered round the old tuck-me-ape-me outfit, and there's not a wax flower out of place. I don't know what the old hypocrite's up to, but whatever it is something extra.
Extraordinary?
No. I speak English, I hope. Extra, meaning something else. Something that's nothing to do with the little bit of now it's your turn over the road. Oh, keep it quiet if you're Christians, like the mere fly stamp this morning. Jas is up to something extra. Nothing to do with worm shoveling and nothing to do with the Palinodes. And we knew that, I should hope, when we got the letter from him in the first place. What he didn't realise was that my employer would make a job of it. And he certainly didn't expect me to come for a brotherly stay. Luring us down here by hinting he could tell us something. Well, he could, but it's not the lot. Miss Ruth Palinode used to like to put a bob on an horse, like anybody else might. Rowley did it for her. Jazz thought it was interesting because it was secret. Ignorant persons often make that kind of mistake. Yeah.
Did she ever win?
Now and again. Lost in the long run, like most women do.
Yes, well, that explains a lot. Money's tight. If one member of the family goes bust, the burden falls on the rest. How's that for a motive?
Though no motive for murder is exactly first class. What is Jas up to, Lug, do you know?
Not yet, cook. Give us an hour. Shifting booze, perhaps.
What gave you that idea?
Oh, it crossed me mind, that's all. It's something heavy that has to be carried careful.
Well, righto, Lug. Keep your eyes open. I'll see you later.
Perhaps you could join me for a spot of meatloaf in the plate layers about 12:30.
Right, good. I'll see you then.
Yeah, he's in a hurry. Late for a funeral, do you think?
Oh, good morning. This is number 59. I'm afraid I'm very late.
Oh, you are, sir. They've been gone over half an hour.
Oh, which way? I mean, it's down there, isn't it?
Well, sir, it's quite a distance. You'd better take a taxi.
Yes, I will. Tell me, they're in limousines, are they?
Oh, why, you can't miss it, sir. It's horse carriages. Very nice and old-fashioned. There's a lot of flowers and a lot of people. And you'll see Mr. John, too.
Yes, indeed. Well, I must hurry. I shall know it. A great many flowers on a perfectly black coffin.
Oh, no, sir. On an oak coffin, and rather light.
Oh, yes.
Oh, you'll know it, sir. Of course you will.
Yes, of course. Yes. I shall take a taxi. Thank you.
Feeling a bit better after your orgy?
Very funny, I'm sure. It shouldn't have happened to a dog. And there's something else funny, too. I was just...
Sorry I'm a bit late, sir. We're short-handed, what with that Greek street shooting. We've got a general call out for the gunman, but no sign of him. Did you see who's in the bar? Clary Grace. Thick as thieves with that old blop lip from the back.
Congreve? They make an unlikely pair.
Don't they? A lot of relationships around here are a bit unusual, if you ask me.
Yeah, like the one in the chemist's.
Far Wild?
It's a rum shop. And the old corpse behind the counter, he's not ordinary. And then, there she was.
What are you talking about?
That's right. Behave like an official. Don't listen and then ask. They missed something on that there island you was going to govern. I am telling you. I went into the chemist for a pickup after my unhappy accident last night. And as I was talking to old Paragonic, in she come. Bella Musgrave. Her as used to batten on the bereaved at funerals.
Oh.
He'd give her a look, and she give him one, and then she went in the back.
Sure.
Yeah, it was her all right. Same black veil, same gentle eyes, full of hypocrisy.
An extraordinary thing.
She's up to something, I'm certain. She might be his auntie. He's the kind of chap to have that kind of relation, but then again, he might not.
Who is Bella Musgrave?
Oh, just a small-time crook whom we once saw sent down for 18 months, selling Bibles in a questionable manner. How did the doctor take your analyst's report?
Oh, resigned, you know. But you remember old Miss Jessica, the gal from the park?
Yes.
Now, he says she's been giving the old man in the dairy cups of poppy tea for his neuralgia. The right poppy at the right time of year, and he'd have been out like a light. Could detain her on suspicion, but it sounds so balmy, doesn't it?
She's not, though. Now, I've just had a session with her solicitor. She persuaded Mr. Lawrence and Mrs. Vadney to agree to his telling all about the family fortunes. She's anxious to assist as much as possible, well, so she says. It seems they all own shares in absolutely worthless commodities. Mr. Edward apparently had a genius for unsuccessful speculation. Nothing came up. Now, there was a rumour that Brownie Mines might have a spark in them, but that fizzled out too.
Mm.
Evadne and Lawrence lost faith in him and kept £7,000 each. Jessica went on longer. Edward died, worth just £75 in cash and £100,000 in various shares, nominal value only. They've all willed their worthless shares to their friends, just to show that they would have done something for them if they'd been able to.
It's true.
Yes, Miss Ruth appears to have had a spiteful streak. She left her parcel of Brownie Mine shares to the captain to pay him back for pinching her room.
Not worth anything, I suppose.
Ah, a motive, you think? No, and no, I'm afraid not. Anyway, there's no reason to think that he knew in advance he was going to get them.
Not much light there, is there?
No, but I think I'll drop a line to Superintendent Yeo. He may be able to shed a little. Oh, by the way, friend Jass has been caught out.
Yeah?
Yes, the Lansbury Terrace affair was a perfectly respectable oak coffin, not Mr. Edward's resplendent ebony.
The old perisher. We'll get him, never you fear.
Dear Yeo, help. There are one or two gaps at this end which need filling, if you will. One, known associates of Lucky Jeffries, housebreaker, currently in Charleswood Infirmary. Two, what has Bella Musgrave been up to lately? Any recent convictions? The local chemist is on her visiting list. Three, is there any henbane growing in Hyde Park? How easy is it to extract hyoscine from it? Four, what do you know about Brownie Mines? Five, what have you been looking for lately, which is A, 5 or 6 feet long, B, distinctive in shape, C, fragile? Silks or old masters in rolls occur to me, but it could be some delicate or illegal piece of machinery. We only ask because we want to know. Yours, Campion.
Ah, there you are.
Ah, Lug, good. You can take this to the post.
Not now, Colt. You wanted it at the chemist's. Mr. Luke sent me.
Why, what's up?
Can't tell you. My lips are sealed. Come on, if you're coming.
This is Dornett.
What have you done? Upset the armor lesson?
I ought to be shot. Struth, I could do it myself. Look at this little lot.
Who is it?
Par Wilde, the chemist. I wasn't even questioning him, really. I'd hardly begun. I met Lug outside the Thespis, and he told me he'd seen a van drive up here about four and take a packing case on board.
That's right. It was heavy, and Par gave him a hand. Two men got up in front of the van, and Bella Musgrave, in her funeral clothes, hopped in her back. Didn't get a chance of a chat. They were off in double quick time, but I got a number.
What shape was the packing case?
Long and thin. I didn't see it close to.
So, what did you say to Par Wilde, Luke, to drive him over the edge?
I just asked about his girlfriend, and he went all coy. So I said, come off it, Par. She's just left here with a box. What's Morning Musgrave done? Taken her little black bag and left you for Jas Bowles? He began to shake. Just a minute, Mr. Luke, he said. Went behind the counter, made a noise like a pheasant, and went down among the bottles. I can't believe it was necessary. The hyacinth may have come from here, but I never suspected him of administering it. He was a silly, vain old chap, not the size for anything big.
Perhaps it wasn't so much what he'd done as what he knew. Did you recognize either of the two men in the van, Lug?
One of them was a perfect stranger that I know, but the other one looked like the ghost of Peter George Jelf. Reunion. That's what it is, Cock.
Who's Jelf?
Well, the Fuller gang was before your time, I fancy. Late 20s, remarkably unchoosy. Jelf was the third in command.
Hired malefactor. Them's the judge's words, not mine. Anyway, Gough, they'd all been upstairs. A room with nothing in it but two hard chairs facing each other. An armchair what Jas had sat in. Must have been him. Great fat dent in the cushion. And a smell of them little whiffy smokes. Oh, he'd been there, and I'd take my oath on it.
Two chairs, eh?
Yeah.
Very suggestive. The question is, What does he put in it?
Eh? Put in what?
The box which rests on the chair.
Mr. Campion, this is a treat, this is.
Ah, we're alone, Mr. Bowles.
Yes, I thought the boy was here in the kitchen, but he's gone back to his work. Maggers is away. As soon as there was that tragedy over the road, he came hurrying in, said goodbye, and we haven't heard of him since. Would you sit here, sir, on my right, so I can hear you better? Oh, it's a very shocking thing, poor Wilde. He wasn't a friend of ours exactly, but we were very close, nodding acquaintances, as one might say. I didn't go to the inquest, but I sent Rowley, out of respect. Suicide when the balance of mind was disturbed, they brought in. Well, that's always the kindest way. We're putting him down tomorrow morning. I don't suppose there'll be a penny to come, but we shall do him with as much luxury as if we were waiting on you yourself.
I wanted to ask you why you bothered to send for me.
Aye, sir. I sent for you. Oh, you're making a big mistake there, sir. I didn't know such thing. I'm glad to see you here, Mr. Campion, because I want the whole thing cleared up, and that's a fact. But no, sir. I didn't send for you, sir.
I can see that a police inquiry wouldn't be very good for your trade.
No, sir.
No, the publicity can't be helpful. And I realise that you knew that Miss Ruth Palinode was in the habit of putting an occasional shilling or two on a horse. But I don't think that point was strong enough to make you send for me.
I didn't send for you, Mr. Campion, but trade is trade, and the police are the first to forget it. I do allow that. Now, there is a little something that perhaps I ought to mention. I only saw one thing that was really curious when Miss Ruth Palinode died. It was a very small thing. May not have had any significance, but it made me think. I saw Mr. Lawrence Palinode washing up.
Really? When was this?
Tea time. Nearly 5. Miss Roper sent Mr. Grace over. I went up alone, all quiet and respectful, for we do tread as light as we can. I hesitated in the doorway, and there he was, washing up.
Mr. Lawrence Palinode?
Yes, sir.
In Miss Ruth's bedroom?
Yes. There was the dead lady, covered with a sheet, and there was her brother. Cool, but nervous, if I make myself plain. With every mortal cup or glass or spoon the room contained out on the old-fashioned washstand, he was dipping the last one into the jug as I came in. It was quite open.
Is that all?
The whole truth, sir. I thought it was significant.
Have you told anybody else?
No one. Well, it's some time ago, and it's only my word against his, isn't it? Could I offer you a glass of anything? Mr. Luke says I drink embalming fluid. That's only his idea of fun.
No, thank you. I'm just going.
Must you? Oh, let me show you out, sir. It's been an honour to have you in our humble home, Mr. Camp.
Oh, there you are, dear. You managed to get round the crowd all right. That's right, Ducky. Oh, people are so gruesome, aren't they? Oh, some of them are reporters, of course. They've gone off the Greek Street shooting now that there's been another death in Apron Street.
Yes, the vultures will gather. They weren't interested in me, I'm glad to say, although the captain and Mr. Lawrence were having some difficulty getting through.
What, together? Oh, they must have made it up then. Oh, they were having such a row earlier on. But Mr. Lawrence is never angry for long, bless him.
I should have thought the captain's resentment would have died with Miss Ruth.
Oh, yes, Ducky, that's all right. It sounded as though they were arguing about those horrible letters the doctor keeps getting. Oh, everybody seems so scratchy nowadays. And Clary's angry with me, too. He says I give the family more than they pay for. Well, what if I do? I can afford it. I won't have him trying to pump old Congreve about my bank account. It is not his business.
Of course not, Auntie.
Oh, I'm sorry, Al, but I do get wound up.
I think I know why you do it. I was looking at Professor Palinode's portrait in the dining room this morning.
Oh, were you, dear?
Well, don't be too clever, will you?
As you like.
Oh, well, by the way, you've got a visitor. Now, he seems quite anxious not to meet anyone, so I put him in your room. Name of Glossop, I think he said.
Glossop?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the only Glossop I know is the financial advisor to the Treasury.
Oh, la-di-da.
I've only met him once or twice.
Well, I don't know, Ducky. I'm sure you'd better go up and see, hadn't you? But don't be late for supper now.
All right, Auntie, I'll be good.
Thank you so much. I'm so unpractical with electrical things.
Yeah.
You must come to my theatrical conversazione tomorrow. Just after six. Don't be late. I get too tired to talk rather soon. Oh, you're out a lot.
Sir William. I hope you've not been waiting long.
Extraordinary woman.
Seemed
to take me for an actor.
Oh, really?
Made me mend an electric kettle.
Yes, yes. Well, she's good at getting people to do things for her.
Is she your murderess?
A runner-up.
I've been talking to Stanislaus Oates, or rather, he's been talking to me. You put a query to Superintendent Yeo. Alarm bells rang. That is why I'm here.
Ah.
Only four reliable people are involved, so that should be all right. Now, Campion, what exactly do you know about Brownie Mines?
Oh, almost nothing. A woman who's been murdered held a number of shares. They're thought to be worthless. Some months ago, there was a rumor about them.
It was thoroughly squashed. Now, I'm not going to commit myself, because the fewer people who know about it, the better. But I'll tell you this much. Three derelict gold mines, I won't say where, of course, are suspected of yielding a certain metal of great scarcity, which is in demand for the manufacture of certain items vital for this country's defense. It's now being investigated. Secrecy is absolutely vital. I tell you, if some fellow has murdered to get hold of that scrip, then he's a crook.
A thoughtless chap all round. Very well. We will know nothing here. Save that there is a motive in the stuff.
Excellent. Keep me posted. And you haven't seen me.
Of course, Sir William. Was it dark when you came in?
Not quite. A pity, since I was so anxious we should not be seen together that I took the trouble to find you instead of fixing a meeting at the club or in the office. But I don't think I was recognized. I'm hardly a public figure.
No, still, it would perhaps be as well if you could go down through the basement kitchen.
Basement?
Well, you see, that way you can avoid the hordes on the front steps. No, you can rely on Miss Roper's discretion.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'll do that.
Goodbye, Captain.
Goodbye.
Dear Amanda, I expect you to receive my other letter by now. I don't know how much longer I shall be away. We're still largely in the dark, though I have great confidence in Charlie Luke. It's rather like working with a human dynamo. He's very young for the job, but he will go far, I'm certain. He never lets go, you see, the best quality for a detective to have. My best love to Sexton Blake Jr., and to you as always, Albert.
It's only beer.
Luke.
What's a country? You drink pretty, I'll have a bottle. Oh, what a day. No go with Edward. Looks like natural causes. Greener's been reported in France. He's one of the Greek Street pair. The other one has vanished into thin air. I've got a couple of chaps going over Par Wild Stock. Nothing there so far. Oh, and the docs had another poisoned letter.
No?
You can read it. Here.
Oh, thank you. Oh, dear, dear. You, blank, 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 etc., etc. Oh, well, he could have spared him that. Blank, 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 dear me. Glass tells all, don't forget. Burning hell? Quite a little viper, isn't she? It is she, I suppose?
Oh, yes, no doubt about it. We've had the shrinks on it.
Well, what it all seems to boil down to is, yes, here we are. The brother is the one who's being clever. He's got what she left to the captain, who is a poor fool. Fascinating, if true.
How come?
because Miss Ruth's legacy to the captain, whom she disliked, was 8,000 preference negotiable shares in a deadly secret. Sit down and listen to me break a confidence. And then I think we must have a word with Lawrence. Forensic medicine, toxicology, mental abnormality and crime. Good Lord, quite a library. Lawrence Palinode becomes more interesting.
Chase me. Foulmouth Feeder again, look.
What?
All by itself on the mantelpiece. Envelope as well.
Addressed to Lawrence?
Yes. Postmarked yesterday.
Marion. Worse and worse. She must be mad. Seems to want to insist, though. You have robbed a fool.
We didn't go over this room when we interviewed him before.
No.
I may as well admit I didn't understand a quarter of what he said last time. He takes me to the fair every time he opens his mouth. But why hasn't he reported this? Looks damn funny to me.
Well, you can ask him now.
Did you seek permission to come in here? I see you have a letter of mine. May I have it?
Do you mean you wrote it?
I? In moments of aberration, I suppose. It's an interesting theory, but hardly tenable. I have seen another like it addressed to the doctor. It is the same handwriting. It's a woman, you know. Well, probably you don't find that as shattering as I do.
Are all these library books?
Most of them. I wished to read up on the subject when I read the first anonymous letter. You see, someone on the inside must have written them. She knows so much about us.
What made you so sure your sister Ruth had committed suicide?
You are remarkably well informed.
You washed up every cup and glass, you see. Had it been only one, we might have been forgiven for arriving at a different conclusion.
The undertaker saw me, I suppose. Ruth was extravagant and had mortgaged her little income. Hic vivimus, ambitiosa, pauperate. Evadne and I taxed her with it. She went to bed very upset and died the next day when it occurred to me that she must have poisoned herself. I rinsed the vessels in her room because, I suppose, I didn't want anyone else to pick up anything dangerous by mistake.
Where did you get the poison?
That really is something for you to find out. The sedge is withered. I know nothing of any details. Ruth had a faulty mathematical streak. She had an absurd system, you know. I worked it out afterwards and found it completely unsound.
Why do you think someone inside the house wrote the letters? Anyone could have told tales to a friend in the meat guild.
It must be someone sympathetic to the captain. The letters accuse me of robbing him, which is ridiculous. I gave him £5, a lot of money for the shares. They were quite worthless, and my sister Ruth left them to Seaton to annoy him, since he is so notoriously short of money. He's not one of the family, and I felt it my duty to see he was not victimized. It was very tasteless of Ruth.
Would you sell them again for a fiver?
Oh, certainly not. I should never sell them. Have you finished your interrogation, Inspector?
Okay, for the moment. You'll remain in the house, won't you, Mr. Palinode? Oh. Shall we go up, sir?
Off to plague Seaton now, no doubt. Close the door behind you, if you please.
It's no use. The captain's had it.
Oh.
Must have drunk the whole bottle. One way of avoiding questioning. He'll have to sleep it off before we get a peep out of him. Here's a letter to you from the super.
Ah, good.
And a pile of memos for me. Nothing on Far Wild, except that he was in debt all round. Doctor's report says undernourished. Suggests blackmail, I suppose. Could have done anything in his time. He was a chemist, wasn't he?
Well, Yeo says Bella Musgrave hasn't stepped over the edge for years. Lucky Jeffries died without saying any more. And an amateur couldn't make high sing from henbane.
My chaps have turned over Bow's shop and found not a thing out of place, except that he was sweating profusely.
Just as he was when I went and asked why he'd sent for me. Oh, he denied it, by the way. Couldn't get rid of me fast enough. And I just caught a glimpse of old Congreve from the bank, hidden in the corner as I left.
Pal of Justice as well, eh? Needs watching, that one.
No sign of an import order for a body or anything.
None. He says there's no call for it nowadays. He's got a nice team of horses, though. You've seen those. And a thing called a coffin break, like a cigar box on wheels.
Nice high box seat for the driver. Must be the last one in the country.
Mm.
I think I go home. Miss Ruth has been poisoned. Pa Wild has done himself in. The captain has put himself out. Jas is innocent but sweating. And we're just exactly where we always were. Don't even know who wrote the filthy letters.
Oh, now, do you know, I've had a thought about that. That other letter to the doctor said, glass tells all, don't forget. You got any fortune tellers on your patch?
I ought to resign on this.
Glass sometimes means crystal ball. And the captain is perhaps vain enough to amuse himself with a few superstitious fancies.
And unwittingly give out information about the family at the same time?
Yes.
Of course. She calls herself Pharaoh's daughter and gives readings for a tanner a time. Lives in a little dark street. Real name... God almighty. Miss Congreve.
What?
Damn it, Campion. She must be that old blop-lip from the bank's sister.
I say, footlights, very pretty.
Candles, courtesy of Rini. Not that Mrs. Batney has noticed. The soiree's upstairs. Shall I announce you?
Formal, is it? No, I don't. Let's just go up.
I'm not invited. I shall be in the kitchen.
How did you get on with the dusky lady?
Pharaoh's daughter. Confessed at 5 this morning. Did it all for the captain. Grievance against the dock. He'd snubbed her sometime. She's crying all over the cells. Congreve slipped out the back way just as we got there, but we've got a call out.
Oh, Albert, there you are.
Oh, hello, dear.
Oh, isn't it awful about my captain? Fancy him having his fortune told by a hook. Well, I ought to mean myself, Ducky. She says he didn't even guess it was her until she admitted it and threatened to post one to Lawrence. When he found out she had, he sneaked upstairs in a blue funk and put himself out with a bottle I didn't even know he had. Oh, I could kill him. I really could.
What are you doing here? Standing guard to see he doesn't get out?
No, to warn my friends not to drink anything, especially the yellow stuff in the glasses. She makes it with groundsel and it has a very funny effect. When you've had enough uplift, dear, come down to the basement. Carrie's got a bit of a bar going. Oh, and by the way, Mr. Lugg's come back. He's waiting in your room.
Oh, right. No, I've never done that. Oh,
Hello. Care for a baked meat?
What are you doing exactly?
Helping Cock. I come round looking for you, and the old girl with a voice like a beak persuaded me to hand around. Funny muck I'm pushing out, but I've took a fancy to her.
Mrs. Vanley?
The elder Miss P, yes. A lovely woman.
Did you find out anything?
No, not a lot. Apron Street used to be a joke until about a year ago, and now no one mentions it anymore. Only bloke I could hear of who actually said he was going up Apron Street was a finger called Ed Geddy. And he ain't been seen since.
Geddy?
Hmm.
Oh, the girl in the kiosk murder, Geddy?
That's the one. Got clean away.
Anything else?
I looked up Peter George Jelf and his little lorry. Looks quite respectable. Got a two-man haulage business in Fletcherstown. Ah, PC Resistance. I've kept till last. The coffin's back.
What?
Startled you, eh? Did me. I peeked through Jazzy's shed window, and there it was. Packed flat.
Do you mean it had hinges?
Might have had, didn't see. It was the right one, all right. Black as a piano, and as much gold on it as a commissioner's trousers. Well, let's get back to the blowout. Now, make up your mind what you're going to add. A cup of yerba mat or a small nettle pot? Yes, there's a rash and something else as well. Mm. Smells as if it come out with the flowers in the oil. There's not a lot of call for that.
Good evening, Mr. Campion. Nice to see you.
Oh, good evening, Doctor. Nice party.
Yes. Is your colleague about?
No, I don't think he...
Oh, it's you.
Oh.
Isn't this wonderful? I put a poultice on the grocer's knee and it's done him good. The doctor admits it, don't you, Doctor?
Oh, well,
Excuse me.
Oh. Lawrence has very little grace. He can't see, you see. But Doctor, you do admit, don't you? Oh, here you are. I'm so pleased to see you.
Good evening, Miss Ballinger.
So great a number of people.
It's certainly a larger gathering than usual.
Grove.
Good evening, Mr. Campbell.
Mr. James.
So, you didn't bring your nice friend Sir William Glossop after all.
Is that the Glossop of the PAEO Trust? A most brilliant man. Was he here?
Oh, excuse me.
Oh, yes. He was waiting for this clever man and did me a little service. He did not introduce himself, but he left his hat on a chair, and I read his name in it. I'm very long sighted. Adrian? Adrian, are you thinking of reciting for us?
I thought that was to be a treat for next time. I do hope so, for I really must not stay today. A most enjoyable evening, Miss Palliner. Good night. Good night.
Good night.
Well, don't let that put you off, Adrian. Hardly a mind.
You're wanted, cock. What? Something's happened to Mr. Lawrence. Miss Roper says he's died.
Oh, poor old chap. Never mind, you're all right now, Ducky. Well, how much longer have you got to go on bothering him, Mr. Luke?
He has something quite different from the others, Campion. A different colour, a different stink.
Did he?
I don't want to commit myself, Luke, but I think it was something more than a purely herbal poison. The tisane probably saved his life by making him vomit, but I think he had something more.
Someone is trying to make it look like my sister Jessica. There was a scrap of leaf in my glass. It was hemlock, classic poison. I recognized it as soon as I hooked it out. Someone is trying to suggest that Jessica poisoned Ruth and Edward, but she wouldn't be so crude.
No one but his maker killed your brother Edward. He had a stroke. I did the Babinski test. It's infallible.
Will you see Miss Jessica now? And Superintendent Yeo's arrived. They're in the dining room.
Come along then, sir. Look after Lawrence, really. Good evening, sir.
What have you got, Luke?
Something has disagreed with Lawrence. Did you know?
Yes.
I did not make a mistake. I made a green nettle drink, and the tansy was yellow. They tell me the stuff Lawrence drank was a deep bottle green.
With leaves in it.
Really? Oh, well, then it could not have been mine. I strain everything most carefully, and I'm very fond of Lawrence.
You are very alike, aren't you? You both so much resemble your father's portrait. And so, oddly, does Miss Roper.
So you know. Yes, her mother danced, I believe. Of course, my father was a just man and provided handsomely for them. Because we are so impractical, he left Renee all his house property, which is why we accept so much from her. Please, please be very discreet. You see, she does not know that we know. That way there is no embarrassment on either side. Oh, Inspector! Is that the glass Lawrence drank from? Do be very careful with it. It is one of Evadne's cherries. She has only two left. They are old Bristol.
Ah, I saw them in her room the first night I came. She must have been entertaining Mr. James in the time-honored manner.
Oh, yes, we always give the bank manager a glass of sherry.
Always?
Yes.
And does the bank reciprocate when you go there?
Invariably.
Lord, what fools! Luke, come on.
Yes, Captain.
You too, Yeo.
Captain.
I hope your net hasn't any holes in it.
I'm not going in without a search warrant, I warn you, Campion. Funny, there must be someone there, a night watchman, somebody.
Yes.
Then I call after him all day, but no sign. I'm trusting you, Campion. Now what's happened?
Okay! It's luck. He's gone in through the window in a shower of glass. Oh, damn it, he's a burglar, isn't he? He'll get the door open, hop it, and we'll rush in and protect the property.
Don't listen. What the hell's that?
It's Jazz. He saved us. He's going up Apron Street before our very eyes. Can we get a car?
Can do.
I hope you know what you're doing, Campion.
Hope on, Governor.
Car Q23 calling all cars. Chief Inspector Luke. and pursuing black horse-drawn vehicle with single passenger driver. Technical name, Coffin Break. Repeat, Coffin Break. Last seen, Barrow Road West, proceeding north. Inform all call points. Over.
It's imperative we get to him before he stops.
If you say so. Where's he going?
I think to Fletcher's town. Peter George Jelf has a haulage business there.
Jelf?
Yes.
That's a coincidence. One of my men ran into him by chance on Euston Station yesterday.
What?
Well, it looked legit, but he glanced into the van out of force of habit, and the only thing he had aboard was a packing case marked Conjurer's Stores.
Ah, so that's it. I wondered how they got the coffin back.
Back?
Over. He's shifting. He's round the park already. Down here, driver. We'll cut him off. Damn it, we've lost him. I'd have sworn he had to come this way.
Let me out. He won't risk going on. He'll unload. He'll get away with it.
Central Control calling car Q23. Message for Chief Inspector Luke. Attention, Joseph Congreve, 51B, Terry Street West. Found dangerously ill following murderous attack. Locked in cupboard, upstairs room, Apron Street branch, Clash Bank, over.
Apron Street? He's in Apron Street. What in hell are we doing here?
Listen. Quick, block the road.
Car isn't broken down, I hope.
Get down, Bowles.
Certainly, Mr. Luke, sir, but I'm on my lawful account.
Tell it all at the station. Get down.
As you say, Mr. Luke. But this isn't like you. Can any of you gentlemen drive? The mare's not quite like a motor.
Don't worry about that. I'll bring your horse myself. Get in the car.
Very good, sir. I'm in your hands. Shall I go first, Mr. Luke?
Open it up, Bowles.
Open it, Mr. Luke. I hardly expected this, sir.
Get on with it. Got a screwdriver?
Of course. Very well. Stand back, gentlemen, if you please. The gentleman died of a bad trouble. There's no need for you to run any risk. We are used to it, of course. There you are, sir. Hope you're satisfied. It's not really very nice.
Wait. Died, I think you said.
Good Lord. What a rig. Doped, but still alive.
Oh, yes, they were all alive, of course. That was the object of the exercise. Greener, your Greek Street bird, was the one before this.
What is it, an escape outfit?
Yes, rather a good one. Awfully well done. Courtesy, sympathy, comfort in transit, in fact. They go to Ireland like this with a mourner laid on to weep them through the customs. Bella Musgrave, no less.
I'll be... Who is doing it all? Him?
No, no. That's a boss in the coffin. A genius in his way, but hopeless of murder. How he managed to kill Miss Ruth successfully, I really don't know.
Champion, there's no way to give evidence. What's the first thing, man?
Sorry, sir. His name is Henry James. He's the manager of the Apron Street branch of Clough's Fact.
Well, that's more like it. Now we're getting somewhere. What have you got to say for yourself, Bowles?
It was done out of kindness. Put that down in writing and never let it be forgot. Hunted animals. That's how I saw them. And that's how I saw him in the finish. You couldn't understand him because you don't know April Street. It was changing and he wouldn't have it. He tried to stop the clock. I sympathised with that, but he didn't ought to have turned to murder. Couldn't bring myself to believe it of him, not at first.
Yet you did, you know. Because after you'd made the mistake of asking your brother-in-law to investigate, you were terrified that James should find out you'd done so,
Ah, you noticed old Congreve in my kitchen that night, did you?
Oh, yeah.
You're very sharp, Mr. Campion, I'll say that. He came round nosing and asking funny questions. And I wasn't sure if he was doing it for James or not, so I wasn't going to speak in front of him, though, in fact, James never trusted him.
Seems to have planned a cosy retirement if the contents of that thing are anything to go by. Is there anything else we want from Bowles at the moment, Campion?
Well, there's always Ed Geddy.
Geddy? Killed the poor little girl who couldn't have blacked his eye for him.
Mm.
Did he get away in this conjuring cabinet too?
Got away. But didn't quite arrive. It was Ed Geddy who gave Apron Street its bad name among the fraternity. Either the drug was too powerful, the coffin too tight, or the journey too long. Ed died at the box. In view of the line he took when he thought Luke was going to raise the subject, Pa Wilde must have dispensed the drug.
It'll be a question of proof, sir, won't it? If it's true.
Oh, well, I think that's about it. The only query is how James knew Miss Ruth's shares in Brownie Mines were going to be worth something after all. It's just one of those top-secret leaks in financial circles, I suppose. But she had told him she'd left them to him in her will, and he did have the opportunity to do her in almost daily, because every time the Palinodes saw their bank manager, at home or in his office, they drank a glass of sherry together.
Get away. No bank's done that for 50 years.
Aha, except this one. Of course, I should have realised sooner. It was Lawrence's green sherry glass this evening that switched on the light.
I didn't realise James had inherited the shares.
No, he didn't. No, she'd already changed her will, so it was all for nothing.
Oh?
Except that he got Lawrence to buy them from the captain, hoping to take them over as security for a small personal loan. Well, that's my bet. And then he thought to clean up the whole thing by polishing off Lawrence and throwing the blame for both murders onto Jessica. But I don't know where he got the stuff from.
I believe I can throw some light there, sir.
Yes, Dice.
We got it out of old Congreve in hospital. James didn't have to get the hyoscine. It was there, in the corner cupboard of his office, right beside the sherry and the glasses, in a sealed glass box marked poison.
Ah.
It had been there as a curiosity ever since the days of Crippen. Lots of people took a morbid interest about it at the time. Congreve had worked in the bank so long, he always knew about it, and noticed when it wasn't there anymore, and told his sister. When they read about Miss Ruth's symptoms, they put two and two together. They were proposing to blackmail James over it.
Wasn't that cupboard ever cleared out? We've had two wars since Crippen was hanged.
Cleaned, but not cleared, sir. It's like a drawing room piece when you get the door open, full of what you might call relics. The whole place is a bit like that. Yeah. We found all the relevant papers in an antique wine cooler in his bedroom. We shall trace all his associates.
Excellent. Excellent. Very neatly wrapped up. I didn't think you were going to get out of this one, Campion.
Your praise is our reward. And now, if you'll excuse me, it is past my bedtime. Good night, Luke. Call on me any time.
Oh, I will. Next time you'll get a wire, if not an escort. Good night, and thanks.
Oh, and about time, too, Ducky. Oh, you are a wonderful man.
Yes.
Look, here's a letter for you, dear.
Oh, thank you.
It came yesterday morning, and nobody thought to give it to you. Come into the kitchen, Ducky, and have some coffee. Clary and Mr. Lug have had a bottle or two, but you're not to be angry with them. It's the relief.
Dear Albert, thank you for letting me know that we're not going to govern that island. I'm so glad. I've been following your case as well as I can from the newspapers, but the reports are very sketchy, I'm afraid, and I fear that any comment I might make would be so wide of the mark as to be irritating. I hope we see you very soon. Lots of love, Amanda. P.S. I can't help it. Have you thought of the bank manager? So shady.
More work for The Undertaker was dramatized for radio by Margaret Eatall, from the novel by Marjorie Allingham, with Francis Matthews as Albert Campion, Geoffrey Matthews as Lug, and Tim Meads as Detective Inspector Luke. Others in the cast, Ronnie Roper, Jennifer Piercy, Jas Bowles, George Parsons, Jessica, Rachel Gurney, Evadne, Sheila Grant, Lawrence and Dice, Manning Wilson, James and Glossop, Philip Manicom, Clarence and Captain Seaton, Howard Gourney, Dr. Smith and Yao, Paul Nicholson, and Congreve, Stuart Organ. Other parts were played by James Good and Stuart Organ. The programme was directed in Bristol by Brian Miller.
Father Brown,
The brother of the vicar of the village where Father Brown has his parish church is a cad and a wastrel. When he's found near the church tower with his head smashed by a very small hammer, the local blacksmith is the first suspect.
The Father Brown Stories by G.K. Chesterton. We present The Hammer of God, adapted by John Scottney, with Andrew Sachs as Father Brown.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore. Amen. Who is it? Can I help you?
I'm sorry. I didn't see you up there.
I'll come down. I'm the rector here, Sir Cuthbert. Berdrick is my name. Wilfred Berdrick.
How do you do, Mr. Yes, well, I must say, it is magnificent. Your rood loft, I mean. So few survived in England, and the roundheads were so strong in these parts. Oh, that carving, filigree work, you call it?
Yes, it is rather fine.
Yes.
I often go out there to pray.
To pray? Up there, above the aisle?
Well, you can look down on the whole church, and a building as noble as this, one should glorify God in all its parts.
Indeed. Yes, I'm sorry I interrupted your devotion.
No, no, I just finished saying evensong to myself, alone as usual. Vespers, I prefer to call it.
Oh.
This is an old priory church, you know, and I like to keep the old monastic hours of prayer each day.
All of them? Well, surely.
All. Prime, terse, sex, nones, vespers, compline. And matins at midnight.
And lords?
Oh, no, not lords. But then, latterly, now it is the monks. 2 o'clock in the morning is a little inconvenient.
Yes.
We don't see many Romans in these parts, Father.
Oh, Brown, I'm sorry, Father Brown. Well, I've been staying with my sister over at Bungay, and as I had a week to spare, I thought I'd follow the old pilgrim route to Our Lady at Walsingham.
Ah, I heard some of your people have revived the shrine. What, 10 years ago?
Yes, March 1897, actually.
There can't be much left of the abbey. How does it go? Bitter, bitter to behold the grass to grow, where the walls of Walsingham so stately did show.
Indeed, yes. Yes, yes, your priory here wasn't the only one to be dismantled by, pardon me, the founder of the Anglican Church. It must have been quite a place to have a chapel like this. It's superb.
Some people do say the tower's disproportionately tall.
Oh.
It was completely rebuilt in the 14th century. The monks made a fortune out of the wool trade, hence St. Cuthbert's, the shepherd's patron, of course.
Yes, yes, yes.
But then my family did well out of it, too.
Your family?
My brother is a local squire.
Ah.
We go back a long way. Look, would you like me to show you around the church?
Oh, well, very much.
Oh,
yes.
Good. Well,
but tomorrow, if possible. I really ought to find somewhere to stay first.
Oh, well, there's only the Blue Boar. It's simple, but clean. And Thurston, the landlord's a good sort.
Oh, good, good.
There's a shortcut out of the west door, then through the blacksmith's yard, which immediately abuts on it. I'll show you.
Oh, thank you so much. I hope you'll be comfortable here, Father. We don't have many visitors.
Yes.
It's a quiet village, not much ever happens.
Thank you, Mrs. Thurston, thank you. I'm sure it will be perfect. The rector spoke very highly of you.
Oh, Mr. Berdrick. He's a good man. A little strange in his ways, but a good man. Not like his brother.
Oh, his brother?
The squire. Supper will be at 7:30, Father, if that suits you.
Oh, yes, thank you so much. Thank you.
A very good evening to you, Rector. Evening, Rector, I said. Wilfred, not a word for your own brother. That's a bit unchristian for a parson, isn't it?
So, Norman, what in heaven's name are you doing sitting outside the Blue Boar in the dark? Oh, I see. You're having your last drink on Tuesday night or your first drink on Wednesday morning.
What? That midnight striking, was it? Well, that's a nice scholastic point, isn't it, Mr. Monk?
I'm surprised, Thurston, that you say drinking so late.
Surprised, Wilfred? Why surprised? Since, as head of our distinguished and ancient family, I own a damn deal, like the rest of the whole stinking village, they will stay serving me as long as I damn well please.
Good night, Norman.
Oh, you're off to pray in your precious church.
Yes.
You're a strange one, Wilfred. Always praying in odd places and at odd times. Unless, of course, you're off to see Mrs. Barnes.
What do you mean?
Very convenient for you, that place being bang next door to the church, and the beauteous Mrs. Barnes being so accommodating.
Don't sully me with your own filth, Norman.
Well, if the parson won't go to comfort a lonely member of his flock, then, like the good landlord I am, I must watch sleeplessly over my people. I'm off to pay a call on Mrs. Barnes myself.
Norman.
Yes?
Are you never afraid of thunderbolts?
Why, this sudden interest in meteorology, dear brother...
I mean, do you never think a god might strike you in the streets?
You and your fairy tales.
If you do not fear God, you have good reason to fear man. Barnes, the blacksmith, is the biggest and strongest man for 40 miles around. Half the village knows of your liaison with his wife.
He's away until late tomorrow morning. I'll be out of his wife's bed long before that. Still, kind of you to warn me. Where's that bottle?
And if he comes back unexpectedly?
Why do you think I'm wearing Father's old deerstalker?
I don't know. Your taste in dress has always been bizarre, Norman, especially when you're drunk.
Because underneath it is... There. The bassinet from the long gallery.
That old helmet? Norman, you're absurd.
On the contrary. Unlike you, my interest in things medieval is purely practical. If Barnes turns up and tries to bit me on the head, the last of the Burdricks is protected by the armor of his forefathers.
And Mrs. Barnes?
She... and fend for herself. And so, Brother Wilfred, good night. Go and pray, Parson, in some unlikely corner of your drafty church with its cold flint tower pointing at the moon. I've warmer work to do. Don't bother to pray for me.
Oh, yes, Norman, there's a prayer for you. Cursed are the unmerciful, fornicators and adulterers, covetous persons, idolaters, slanderers, drunkards, and extortioners. Amen.
So I thought I'd come early. Oh, it's such a beautiful morning, isn't it? And just to check that you really do celebrate Prime. Sure enough, sharp at six, here you were, Mr. Burdrick. Burdrick, that's B-O-E-D, is it? It's a Saxon name, surely?
Yes, yes. It's, we were one of the few Saxon families allowed to keep our lands by the Conqueror.
Oh?
Yes, it was said to be in recompense for my ancestor betraying Hereward the Wake to the Normans.
Ah,
if yes. So, it was an act not uncharacteristic of my family. My brother, I fear, is...
Yes?
Well, I won't bore you with family matters.
Oh, dear.
Oh.
Oh, dear. Who is that unfortunate creature?
They call him Mad Joe. He's... Oh, poor fellow. He's the blacksmith's brother. I've not seen him in here before. The blacksmith's wife is a member of my congregation, but the blacksmith himself is a staunch nonconformist. Well, so is Joe, if he's anything. Family always has been, right back to Puritan days. Would you excuse me, Father Brown? I must see if I can find out what he wants.
Of course, I mustn't interfere with your pastoral duty. Besides, I must get back to breakfast.
Joe, what is it?
That's what I like to see, a nice clean plate, Father. Were they all right then, the bloaters?
Oh, yes, delicious, Mrs. Thurston.
We were at St. Cuthbert's earlier, were you? The rectory seems to spend all his time there. Oh. When he's not praying, he's pottering about fixing the woodwork or something. His brother, the squire, say he cares more about Gothic architecture than God. Oh, that reminds me. I must apologise to you for the Squire's behaviour last night. Oh, he's got a coarse tongue on him, especially when he's in drink.
No,
and if you
not
don't...
at all. Not... I felt sorry for
Toast,
you.
Toast, Father. Your marmalade's all made.
Toast, where is he,
come on in. That's open.
Mavis, let me use your telephone, will you? Oh. I got a telephone headquarters. I am just... Oh, sorry. I didn't know you had company.
Father Brown, this is Constable Barton. Wait, what is it? What are we talking?
It's the Squire.
What's he done this time?
Nothing. No, never will do nothing again. He's dead. Oh. Murdered by Simeon Barnes, the blacksmith.
Sorry.
Yeah. Oh, it's horrible.
Oh, he had it coming to him, I'll say that. But you catch Simeon, did you?
Oh, no, no. He's disappeared, he has. But Gibbs the cobbler, he found the squire in Simeon's yard. He'd obviously, saving your presence, Reverend, just spent the night with Simeon's missus.
Couldn't it be the first time?
I reckon the blacksmith bumped into the squire this morning on his way home from wherever he'd been. He sees the squire coming out of his house, puts two and two together, then on the spur of the moment, picks up a hammer and hits him. It was done with a hammer. Still lying there, it is.
And it was definitely the blacksmith who did it?
Oh, no question, Reverend. Squire's skull is smashed to bits. Oh. Right gory mess it is. No one round here's got the strength to do that, save Simeon Barnes. And he's the man who had most reason for doing it. Right, stand back, please, folks. Inspector says no one's got to touch the body. Not as I reckon anybody would want to much state it's in. Oh, and Gibbs, he says you wasn't supposed to touch the hammer neither. He should be here soon, the Inspector. George Ruffin's got to meet him at the station with his gig. Oi, Gibbs, you heard. Leave it alone.
They can't hang Simeon, you know, Constable. Crime of passion. That means an automatic acquittal. Isn't that true, Doctor?
Mr. Gibbs, you're talking through your hat. That's France, if it's true anywhere. Has anyone told Wilfred? Where is he?
A terse. 9 o'clock. He should be on his way up here towards the church.
Well, I'll be... You're quite right. Here he is.
Rector! Rector!
Dr. Wesley, Father Brown, what has happened?
Well...
What are all these people?
Now...
Oh, I see him. Oh, my God. Oh, God, have mercy on his soul.
Come into the church, Wilfred, away from all these people.
Oh, I prayed for my brother's soul and sought forgiveness for his many sins.
Yes, yes, so have I. And for all who commit sins.
His head has... I had no idea.
It must have been an incredible blow. Even for a man as strong as Simeon Barnes.
Simeon Barnes? Are they accusing the blacksmith? No, 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 not him. He could never be him, never.
Why not?
Why not? Why? Because he is nothing if not what they used to call a God-fearing man. His is a harsh, imperious, unforgiving Christianity, but to him the Ten Commandments are an law. He could never do this.
But don't the Ten Commandments say, thou shalt not commit adultery?
They also say, thou shalt not kill. How did Mrs. Barnes take the squire's death, Doctor?
Well, that was the rum thing. She was in tears. Not tears of grief, really. More hysterical. When she saw the corpse, she said, the devil, the devil. And then she muttered something I couldn't hear. And then, I swear, she went as if to spit on the body.
Oh, what do you think of my brother's injuries, Father Brown?
His, I don't know. I know very little about, I hardly saw. But to tell you the truth, I was much more interested in the hammer.
The hammer?
Yes. Very small, didn't you think? And there's something else about it. I think so, at least. But the trouble is, I don't really know much about hammers.
Excuse me, gentlemen.
Yes, Constable?
Inspector Stone from Ipswich. He's here. He'd like you all to come over to the Blue Boar. Wants to ask some questions.
What's happening, Gibbs?
Oh, I reckon he's balmy. That inspector asked me if Squire had any enemies. Do better ask if he had any friends, said I. Father Brown?
Yes, Mr. Gibbs.
Inspector would like to see you next, sir. He's through the back room.
Yeah. I'm so sorry.
Do you want me to use your umbrella, Father?
Oh, no, of course not.
Would you mind?
Thank you so much. Oh, dear. Excuse me.
Father Brown?
Yes.
Fine. Shut the door, Constable.
Sir.
You know Constable Barton?
I'd just like
to confirm. I do think.
Oh, thank you so much.
Confirm some times.
Yes.
Now, according to my records, you passed through the blacksmith's yard coming from the church at approximately 6:45 a.m.
Yes, indeed.
I'd like to confirm that the body was not there at the time.
Oh, no, it wasn't. I'm sure I'd have noticed it. Inspector, may I ask, what does Mr. Barnes look like?
I don't rightly know, sir. What does he look like, Barton?
Big fellow, sir. Red hair, cut short.
Oh, that is interesting. That's very interesting.
Did you see him this morning, sir?
This morning? No, not this morning. No. No, through the window here. He's coming up the lane with two fellows I know from Bungie.
That's him, sir. Quick, out the back way.
Hey, Simeon, we'd like a word with you.
What's going on here?
I won't ask you, Mr. Barnes, whether you know anything about what has happened here. You're not bound to say. I hope you don't know and that you're able to prove it. But I must go through the proper form. Simeon Barnes, I arrest you in the name of His Majesty King Edward VII for the murder of Major Norman Ethelred St. Just Burderick.
Is Major Burderick dead?
Yes, I'm afraid he is.
And he's damned. When did this dog die in his sense?
Hey, moderate your language, Simeon.
Moderate the Bible's language and I'll moderate mine. When did he die?
He was alive at midnight, dead before 8 this morning.
God is good. Arrest me if you wish, Mr. Inspector. But there are two men standing here, good tradesmen of Bungie, who'll swear that they saw me from before midnight till daybreak, and along after in the committee room of our revival mission in Bungie, which sits all night we save souls so fast. Many others too saw me.
Yes, I can vouch for both these men from Bungie, Inspector. John Boardswell.
Oh, morning, Father.
Oh, good morning, John. And Josiah Risby, I know you both, don't I?
You do, sir.
You do, Father Brown. And what are you doing here, sir?
Well, I...
Josiah Risby, you know this handmaiden of the Scarlet Woman.
Of course I do. Everyone in Bungay knows Father Brown, don't they, John?
Shame on you, Josiah. And I thought you a Christian man.
My dear fellow.
I hope I've convinced you, Inspector. If you ask me, no fleshly power killed the Major. He who in the stillness smokes Sennacherib. He it were slew the great beast. And high time too, say I.
That agent is outside my jurisdiction, Mr. Barnes.
You are not outside his. See you to it.
Mrs. Thurston, your beer is as good as your cooking.
Thank
you,
Father.
Wilfred, here's your drink.
What? Oh, thank you. Do you know, I can hardly believe it's so early. It's been a long morning.
And we're further from the solution than ever.
Ah, Father Brown.
Yes. I've been thinking about what you said, you know, the hammer being too small.
Yes.
Who would use a small hammer, I thought, with 10 large hammers lying about? Only the kind of person that can't lift a large hammer, of course.
Mm-hmm.
A bold woman might commit 10 murders with a light hammer, but she couldn't kill a cockroach with a heavy one. And, I mean, why do people always assume that the only person who hates a wife's lover is her husband? 9 times out of 10, the person who most hates the wife's lover is the wife herself. And who knows what insolence and treachery the squire had shown her.
No, Dr. Wesley. Mrs. Barnes could not have killed my brother. No woman ever born could have done it. You haven't grasped the whole of it. He was wearing an iron helmet. The blow shattered it like broken glass.
Well, I may be wrong. There are objections to everything. But I stick to the main point. No man but an idiot would pick up a little hammer if he could use a big hammer.
What did you say? That was the word I wanted. What did you say?
I said no man but an idiot would...
Exactly. No man but an idiot did. When I was in church this morning, a madman came in to pray that poor Joe has been wrong all his life. God knows what he prayed, but it's not incredible to suppose that a lunatic would pray before killing a man.
But why would he want to kill him?
The motive? My brother was always cruelly teasing him. Or perhaps he'd seen my brother with his brother's wife and felt he was defending the family honour in some way.
By Jove, this is talking at last.
Interesting.
Don't you see, this is the only theory that answers both riddles. The little hammer and the big blow. The smith might have struck the big blow, but he would not have chosen the little hammer. His wife might have chosen the little hammer, but could not have struck the blow. A madman, being mad, might have chosen the first thing that came to hand.
Yes.
And as for the big blow, well, have you never heard, Doctor, that a maniac in his paroxysm may have the strength of 10? Of course, Joe could never be prosecuted. If ever a man could plead insanity, it's poor Mad Joe.
By golly, I believe you've got it. What do you think, Father Brown?
Well, you know, I think I prefer Simeon Barnes' idea that, what was it, no fleshly power was involved?
But I don't understand, Father.
Well, surely, Father, it has to be the lunatic. Oh, look at the time. Oh, excuse me, gentlemen, I must go. I have to be in church. It's nearly the sixth hour.
Oh, yes, of course. Perhaps when you've finished your office, I might come over and join you?
Oh, yes, of course. Of course, Father.
What did he mean, the sixth hour? It's almost midday.
Well, the monks started their day at 6 in the morning, hence they called midday the sixth hour, sext. It was their third office.
So you see, Father, although to a great extent we escaped the ravages of the Puritans, I've had to contend with the ravages of time.
Yes, you've done wonders, Mr. Burdrick. Mrs. Thurston told me you were a handy man, but you're a carpenter, a craftsman. That's hard to tell which poppy heads are original and which ones are carved by you. Still, I suppose if a blacksmith can be a preacher, there's no reason why a clergyman shouldn't be a master carpenter.
Well, I'm hardly the first.
What? Oh, yes, indeed, yes. I wonder, would it perhaps be possible to go up your famous tower? I'd like to see the view.
Well, as you wish. But be warned, it's a long haul.
Oh, yes. Here. Oh, look at that. Might be a map of the world, mightn't it, down there?
Yes.
Yes. Do you come up here to pray, too, Mr. Burdrick?
Yes, frequently. It all looks so tranquil from here, the village, the rich flat farmlands. You can sometimes see the sea.
That's the smith's yard, isn't it, immediately below?
Yes.
Do you know, there's a kind of Titan energy in medieval architecture. It always seems to be rushing away. Seen from below, this church springs up like a fountain at the stars. And from here, it's more like a cataract pouring into a voiceless pit.
Be careful of looking so sharply down. It can be disturbing.
Yes. Yes, there's a monstrous disproportion. From below, this huge stone griffin. Yes, it looks quite small and harmless. But from here, it's like a great dragon stalking the fields. You know, heights were made to be looked at, not looked from.
Yes, one may fall.
One's soul may fall if one's body doesn't.
I scarcely understand you.
I think there's something rather dangerous about standing on these high places, even to pray.
Father?
Yes?
You don't believe Mad Joe did it, do you?
No.
It would explain the small hammer.
Yes. But we know he didn't do it, don't we? Joe would have used a blacksmith's hammer, a hammer used to work metal. But the weapon was a hammer of another kind, one used for working wood, a carpenter's hammer.
Father Brown,
you know, there was a man once who began by worshipping with others, kneeling on the floor before the altar, but who grew fond of high and lonely places to pray from. And in one of those dizzy places where the world seemed to turn under him like a wheel, his brain turned also, and he came to fancy he was God. It must seem easy to judge the world from up here, to believe it is given to you to strike down the sinner.
You? Are you a devil?
I am a man, and therefore have all devils in my heart. From here it all looks so simple, doesn't it? Whether you come up here to pray, or with a set of carpenter's tools to mend a wooden railing, to look down and see all men as insects, and to see one particular poisonous insect.
How do you understand all this?
It's so simple, not just to judge, but to execute sentence. For you have at hand, here, one of the awful engines of nature, gravitation, that mad and quickening rush by which all things of the earth fly back to her heart. The dreadful, unfleshly power of gravitation, whereby if dropped from a great height, even a small hammer would strike as a lethal bullet.
No,
come back, come here. No, I will quite simply not allow you to jump. That door leads to hell. Now come down to earth with me. You're not yet far wrong, as assassins go. You would not allow the crime to be fixed on the smith or his wife. You tried to fix it on the imbecile who could not be punished. Come away from these stone-carved angels and devils. Come down into the world of men. And when we reach the floor of the nave, I will leave you there at ground level to make your own decision. And then go your own way, as free as the wind. I will seal this with the seal of the confessional. Now, I've said my last word.
Trent's Last Case is a detective novel written by E. C. Bentley and first published in 1913. Its central character, the artist and amateur detective Philip Trent, reappeared subsequently in the novel Trent's Own Case, 1936, and the short story collection Trent Intervenes, 1938. Trent's Last Case is actually the first novel Philip Trent appears in, and is a whodunit with a place in detective fiction history because it is the first major send-up of that genre. Not only does Trent fall in love with one of the primary suspects usually considered off-limits, he also, after painstakingly collecting all the evidence, draws all the wrong conclusions.
Trent's Last Case by E.C. Bentley, dramatized by Alan Downer, with Martin Jarvis as Trent. The year is 1913.
Editor's office.
I have a call for Sir James on an outside line.
I'm afraid Sir James is very busy this afternoon.
The gentleman says he's secretary to Mr. Sixby Manderson.
In that case, excuse me, Sir James.
Yes, Silver, what is it?
A man who claims to be secretary to Sixby Manderson wants to speak to you. I've said you're busy, but...
Not so busy I won't speak to Sixby Manderson's secretary.
Put the man on.
One moment, please. You're through.
Hello?
Sir James Molloy?
Speaking.
My name is Calvin Bunner. I'm speaking from the Manderson residence just outside Bishopsbridge.
How can I help you, Mr. Bunner?
I have some information for you. For exclusive use in your two newspapers. It's about Mr. Manderson.
Yes?
His body was found this morning in the grounds of this house.
His
body.
He's been shot in the head.
Just a second, Mr. Bunner. Silver! Hunt up Figgis, young Williams, the infallible Mrs. Morgan, and someone from the business section. Assemble them in the conference room now.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, your full attention, please. Sigsbee Manderson has been murdered. Consequently, we'll be bringing out a special edition this evening and a full story in the Record tomorrow. Williams,
sir,
instruct Mr. Anthony to prepare for a two-column opening that will knock the town endways. Tell him to take all measures and precautions for a scoop. Say that Figgis will be over in 5 minutes with the full story.
Yes, sir.
And then come straight back.
Yes, sir.
You ready, Figgis?
Sir.
Sigsbee Manderson and his wife, with two secretaries, have been for the past fortnight at the house called White Gables at Marlstone near Bishopsbridge. He bought it 4 years ago, and he and Mrs. Manderson have been in the habit of spending part of each summer there. Last night, he went to bed at 11:30 as usual. No one knows what time he got up and left the house, but his body was discovered at 10 o'clock this morning by one of the gardeners. It was lying by a shed in the grounds of the house. He had been shot through the left eye, and death must have been instantaneous. Dr. Stock of Marlstone will conduct a post-mortem examination. So far, the police have no clue as to the identity of the murderer. Got that?
Yes, sir.
Well, knock some shape into it and we're away.
Yes, sir. How about this for a headline? Napoleon of Wall Street murdered.
How about murder of Sigsbee Manderson? Keep it simple.
Yes, right.
Anything else?
Yes. How about one of the ablest detectives at Scotland Yard has been put in charge of the case?
It's a safe statement. Why not?
And Mrs. Manderson, was she there?
She was.
Then how about some human interest? She's prostrated by shock and is seeing no one.
I don't think so, Mr. Figgis. Forgive me, Sir James.
Mrs. Morgan?
I once saw Mrs. Manderson, and she looked quite healthy and intelligent. She won't be prostrated by shock, I don't think. She'll be more likely to be doing all she can to assist the police.
I'm on my way, then.
Yes, cut along. Mr. Anthony's expecting you. And use his private office. At this stage, we can't be too discreet.
Sir.
Right, it's your turn, Mrs. Morgan. I expect you know what I want from you.
I did anticipate something of the kind, Sir James, so I've come prepared. Mm-hmm. Our Manderson biography is well up to date. Would you like to see it?
Please. And if you've a copy for Mr. Edison here.
Of course. It's a touch hyperbolic, perhaps. All that about having been the foe of the raiding chieftains that infest the borders of Wall Street.
Edison, what do you think?
Well, I'm sure of one thing. The moment this news gets out, the bottom will fall out of Wall Street.
Well, you'd agree with this, then. To speak the name of Manderson was to call up a vision of all that was broad-based and firm in the vast wealth of the United States?
Absolutely. They don't call him the Colossus for nothing.
That's not all they called him.
What?
Miners, steelworkers, cattlemen. Tens of thousands of workers all across America and elsewhere had every reason to curse his name.
You smashed a strike or two, yes.
Using methods that were both ruthless and lawless.
Always in pursuit of legitimate business ends.
Forgive me, Mr. Edison, but only a finance editor would find that a valid excuse.
That's below the belt, Mrs. Morgan.
I assure you, Sir James, that none of my personal views about Manderson will find their way into his obituary. Shall we go on?
Please do.
You will see that the salient biographical details are as follows. Born in New York in 1860 and given the best education that money can buy. Mm-hmm. As a young man, went into business on his own account and soon won the dubious reputation of being an infant prodigy in the field of financial speculation. A gambler of genius, pitting his wits against all comers in the dogfight of the New York Stock Exchange.
And mostly coming out on top.
Quite. When his father died in 1889, Manderson took over the family banking business and changed overnight, turning his back on Wall Street and by hard work and keen brain, winning control of the company and a reputation as a pillar of the financial establishment.
A poacher turned gamekeeper, you might say.
In 1907, he met and married Mabel Domecq, an English lady barely half his age.
Mm.
There are no children.
And so on and so forth. Right, Mrs. Morgan, let's print it.
You said I was to report back, Sir James.
Yes, Williams, thank you. I just want you to stand by and give Mrs. Morgan a hand.
Yes, sir.
Have we any photographs?
No shortage of those. I'll send a selection down to you at once and you can choose.
Excellent.
We also have two very good portraits. One, a sketch by Mr. Trent, when they were fellow passengers on the same ship somewhere. It's a splendid likeness.
You know our public, Mrs. M. They always prefer a bad photograph to a good drawing. But on the subject of Trent, Silver.
Yes, sir?
Get him on the telephone for me now, will you?
Yes, sir.
You're putting him on the case, Sir James?
I don't think he'll take much coaxing. Come along, Edison. We'll discuss the financial aspect as we go.
Right, Sir James.
Who is this Mr. Trent, then?
Philip Trent?
Hmm.
A painter. His pictures sell, what's more. Early 30s. Handsome. Full of fun.
A painter? So what have you want with him?
A few years ago, there was a murder committed in a railway train in very puzzling circumstances. Trent applied his mind to the case and later sent a long letter to Sir James because his newspaper had, as usual, contained the fullest and most intelligent version of the facts. Oh, pass me those photographs, would you?
Certainly.
And in his letter, Trent did what Poe had done in the case of the murder of Mary Rogers.
Oh, yeah.
With nothing but the newspapers to guide him, Trent drew attention to the significance of certain apparently negligible facts so as to throw grave suspicion onto a man who had presented himself as a witness. Sir James printed the letter and in the next edition was able to announce the arrest and full confession of the incriminated man.
Well, well.
Since then, Sir James has paid Mr. Trent large sums to unravel similar problems for the paper at home and abroad. And he's been amazingly successful. However, Mr. Trent always returns to his painting. Oh,
let's hope he'll solve this one for us then, eh?
I'm sure he will. Sadly, if he travels by train, which is his usual preference, he won't be in Marlston till breakfast time tomorrow. The only good train left half an hour ago. The next is a slow one leaving Paddington at midnight.
You know your Bradshaw by heart, do you, Mrs. Morgan?
A good newspaper man, Williams, is supposed to know everything.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes?
You're Mr. Trent, aren't you? Mr. Philip Trent?
Yes, that's right.
I recognised you from your photographs. I'm a great fan. And something of an amateur sleuth myself. The way you solved that murder at Ilkley, I really don't know how you did it. Quite spectacular.
No, thank you. I'm afraid you have the advantage of me, Mr.
Abbott.
Abbott?
Henry Abbott. I'm manager of the Castle Hotel. The newspaper telephone booked you a room. Said you'd be arriving on this train.
Indeed. And you very thoughtfully came to collect me. Well, I'm most indebted, Mr. Abbott.
All night journeys aren't much fun, are they? Oh, well, can I take your bag, sir?
Thank you very much.
Oh,
I'm quite fond of railway travelling, as a matter of fact. It has a certain appeal. I am the stoker and the stoked.
I am the song the porter sings.
Beg your pardon, sir? Nothing, it doesn't matter. I'm packed for a longish stay, I'm afraid. One never knows with these matters.
Are you immediately hungry for your breakfast, sir?
Why do you ask?
Because I thought you might like to drive to the hotel via Dr. Stock's surgery.
Oh?
It's the last chance you'll have to see the body. It's to be post-mortem this morning.
Are you able to arrange it?
It's a mighty regular, sir, but one is not without one's influence in the village. It's all laid on already, and the doctor's waiting.
As you'll observe, Mr. Trent, the shot in the eye scarcely disfigured the face at all and caused scarcely any effusion of blood.
Nor are there any powder burns visible, indicating he was not shot at close range.
Quite so, Mr. Abbott.
And, to my mind, eliminating the possibility of suicide.
Besides which, no weapon was found near the body.
And whoever heard of a suicide shooting himself through the eye?
Oh, good point, Mr. Trent, good point.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Abbott, thank you. Now, what interests me more are his wrists.
What about them?
See these bruises and scratches?
I'd observe them, of course, at my initial examination.
Suggestive of a struggle, I'd say.
That's what it looks like. Also of interest are his shirt cuffs.
In what way, sir?
Well, with someone dressed as formally as this, you'd expect the cuffs to be well down over the wrists.
Perhaps in the struggle.
Possibly. Now, you gentlemen must have seen something of him on his previous visits to White Gables. Would you have called him a well-dressed man?
I'd have called him a swell.
Yes, he was always quite fastidious in his dress.
Because there's something else that's rather odd. Look at his shoelaces.
My word, those laces were tied in a hurry.
That's my point about the cuffs. They're dragged up inside the coat sleeves as if he'd hurried into his coat without pulling them down. That's why the wrists are visible.
He parted his hair carefully enough.
Yeah, that parting's a work of art.
Also, if he was in a hurry, why did he put on so much? Complete outfit of underclothing, studs in the shirt, sock suspenders, a watch, chain, money, key.
Why, indeed.
On the other hand,
what?
He'd neglected to put in his false teeth.
It doesn't add up.
And there's Something else.
What?
His watch. It's in the wrong pocket. Look, one of the waistcoat pockets is lined with wash leather to accommodate a watch. But he'd put his into the pocket on the other side.
And what do you deduce from that?
Oh, nothing for the present, Doctor. I must reconnoitre the ground first. Well, gentlemen, thank you both for your invaluable assistance.
Oh, my pleasure.
Now, I think it's time for breakfast.
My dear Trent, I was half expecting you.
Well, well, well. Nathaniel Burton Cupples. How are you, my best of friends?
I'm tolerably well, thank you. Oh, you're looking splendid. Will you join me for breakfast?
Oh, rather. I've worked up quite an appetite. Waiter.
Yes, sir.
I'll start with grapefruit, and then I think a sole.
Yes, sir.
But I shan't eat again till this evening, very likely. I expect this to be a hard day.
I take it you've come down to write about the murder.
Oh, that's rather a colourless way of putting it. I should prefer to say I'm here to hunt down the guilty and vindicate the honour of society. I've had one slice of luck already. I've been allowed to view the body. Now I must somehow manage to get on the right side of the people at the house.
Mm. Well, that is precisely the point on which I can be of assistance to you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, allow me to explain. Mrs. Manderson is my niece.
What? Cupples, are you jesting with
me? No, I'm perfectly serious. Her father, John Peter Domecq, was my late wife's brother. Now, she's bearing up wonderfully well, Trent. She has remarkable fortitude of character.
Grapefruit, sir?
Oh, thank you.
Mm. And will it be tea or coffee?
Tea, please. A large pot.
Very good, sir.
Now, will your niece allow me to see her?
Well, she has a great horror of the newspapers.
Yeah.
And is doing her utmost to keep journalists away. But I mentioned that you might be down and told her you were a personal friend. And it ended with her saying that if you should come, she would like you to be helped in every way. However,
yeah?
She will prefer not to see you herself just yet. She's keeping to her own sitting room. She's been interviewed by a detective from Scotland Yard and feels unequal to any more.
I quite understand.
Now, there are two secretaries and Martin the butler, who she thinks can tell you all you want to know.
Cupples, is there anything about this business that you know and would rather not tell me?
Well, what on earth do you mean?
I mean about the Mandersons. Is it? What strikes me as odd about this affair is that here is a man, a famous man, suddenly and violently killed, and nobody's heart seems broken. Doctor, hotel manager, have been his neighbours for years, both spoke about him as coolly as though they'd never set eyes on him.
Well, the truth is that nobody liked Manderson. And those who were nearest to him liked him least of all. As for my niece, I know her to be an amiable and honourable woman, but for some time past, Manderson had made her miserable.
In what way?
She said it was as if he were nursing a perpetual grievance. Mm. He maintained a distance between them and would say nothing.
And this estrangement had been going on for how long?
Oh, several months. At last, a week ago, she wrote asking me to come down and talk to him on her behalf. She was adamant she wouldn't do so herself, so I agreed. I refused to go to White Gables, disapproving, as I do, of the use to which Manderson on several notorious occasions put his vast industrial power, so I watched my opportunity and met him as he passed by this hotel. We spoke just inside the gate there.
And?
Well, I told him what Mabel had confided in me and asked how he could justify his behaviour towards her.
How did he receive that?
Not very well. He told me not to butt in. Said Mabel was well able to take care of herself, as he had found out, among other things. I insisted he explain. He refused. He said, this thing has gone far enough, I guess. And he turned to go.
Did he mean your interview?
Oh, you'd think so, wouldn't you, from the words alone. But it was the way he uttered them, and the fierce light in his eye. I received the impression he'd formed some sinister resolve.
Good heavens. What did you do?
I flew into a rage. I love my niece, and in the heat of the moment I said a number of foolish things at the top of my voice and within earshot of several of the hotel guests, concluding with a statement that I thought him unfit to live.
not very typical of you, Cupples.
No, but at least it relieved my mind.
Mm. And Manderson?
Oh, he smiled slightly, but I could see a vein swelling in his forehead. It's not a pleasant sight. Then he turned away and strolled off towards White Gables.
And this happened
on Sunday morning.
And you never saw him again?
No. Or rather, yes, once, later in the day, on the golf course. But I didn't speak to him. And next morning he was found dead. I I tell you all this, my friend, because I fear that you will find it out for yourself and suspect Mabel of having had something to do with the crime, and that's simply not possible.
Mm. So?
Ah, thank you. Mm. Well, it'll be a shame to hurry this. It looks delicious. But I'm being paid a vast sum by Sir James to solve a murder. I must get over to White Gables.
What will you do first?
Visit the scene of the crime, I think. The spot where the body was found. Something might turn up.
Mr. Trent, I presume? Oh, did I give you a start? I'm sorry.
That's all right.
My name is John Marlowe. I'm Mr. Manderson's personal secretary.
Ah, yes.
Mr. Couples telephoned from the hotel. You are expected.
Oh, good.
Have you found any clues?
Not one. I've ransacked the hut. I've covered every inch of the ground. Nothing at all. It's a terrible business, Mr. Marlowe.
Yes.
You look worn out.
I was driving the car all Sunday night and most of yesterday, and I didn't sleep well last night after hearing the news.
Who would?
Indeed. Listen, I'll have to leave you now. I have to arrange about the inquest. But if you go up to the house and ask for Mr. Bunner, he'll look after you.
Thank you.
Oh, by the way, there's a detective here already. Inspector Murch from Scotland Yard.
Inspector Murch, eh?
He arrived yesterday. He's in the library.
You didn't waste any time, Inspector.
Ah, Mr. Trent.
I did think I was ahead of Scotland Yard this time. How did you get here so soon?
I was on leave with the missus at Halvey, 12 miles down the coast. I bicycled over yesterday evening.
So you have the head start.
Oh, I don't mind bringing you up to date. I know you'd do the same for me if the positions were reversed. Seen the body?
Oh, yes, yes, thank you. And the place where it lay?
You haven't wasted very much time yourself.
So, what are your first impressions?
It's all very puzzling. Now, to start with, I guessed it might be common robbery and murder by some tramp. But there's not the slightest trace of any attempt at burglary and the body wasn't robbed. My second thought was suicide.
Ah.
But, as I'm sure you'll agree, Mr. Trent, the facts are all against it.
Hmm. So, who do you suspect?
Everybody. At this stage of affairs, it's the only safe principle. Now, first of all, there's Mrs. Manderson.
Yes?
Seems she and Mr. Manderson weren't getting along so well just lately. And she was the last person he spoke to as he retired for the night. They occupied adjoining rooms, you see.
You have looked over them?
Yeah. It's interesting. Him being a millionaire, you'd think he'd have gone in for luxury. But his bedroom's bare. Almost like a cell. It opens onto his wife's room. Now, not much of the cell about that, I can tell you. There's a lady who enjoys the pretty things in life.
Hmm. What about this room?
Oh, they call it the library. Manderson used to do his writing in here. I've been through the desk this morning with the American secretary. Bunner, his name is, and a queerer card I never saw turned. Now, he's got it into his head that his boss had been receiving threatening letters and that the murder was the outcome of that.
Any evidence?
None at all. All we found were business letters, reports, prospectuses in there. Just what you'd expect.
Mm.
The only unusual thing we found were some packets of banknotes to a considerable amount and a couple of little bags of unset diamonds.
Diamonds?
Seems Manderson had begun buying diamonds lately as a speculation. A new game, Banner said. I told him to put them in a safer place.
Mm, good. Now, what did Manderson want with two secretaries?
I asked him the same question. The arrangement was that Bunner was his right-hand businessman, one of his office staff, whereas Marlowe looked after his motors and yacht and horses and sporting arrangements and that.
I see.
The last member of the staff to see Manderson alive was Martin the butler. I had his story last night and very glad he was to tell it. An affair like this is meat and drink to the likes of him. Would you like to talk to him?
If it wouldn't bore you to hear what he has to say again.
Well, they say suffering is good for the soul.
I last saw Mr. Manderson.
No, please, not that yet. Tell me all you saw of him that evening. After dinner, say.
After dinner, sir? Yes. I recall that after dinner, Mr. Manderson and Mr. Marlowe walked up and down the path through the orchard talking.
Have you any idea what they were talking about?
Well, it seemed important because I heard Mr. Manderson say, as near as I can remember, if Harris is there, every minute is vital. You want to start right away, and not a word to anyone. Mr. Marlowe answered, "Very well, I'll just change out of these clothes and I'm ready." Or words to that effect. Mm-hmm. Mr. Marlowe then went up to his bedroom and Mr. Manderson came in here and rang for me. He handed me some letters for the postman in the morning and observed that Mr. Marlowe had persuaded him to go for a drive in the car by moonlight.
What time was this?
About ten, sir, I should say. Mr. Manderson then joined Mrs. Manderson in the drawing room, which struck me as curious, as I had not known him enter that room since we came to White Gables this year, preferring to remain alone in here. However, he did only remain with Mrs. Manderson for a few minutes. Then he and Mr. Marlowe drove off in the direction of Bishopsbridge.
And did you see Mr. Manderson again later?
About an hour later, yes, sir. And once again here in the library.
He rang for you?
Yes, sir. Said he wanted someone to sit up until 12:30 in case an important message should come through by telephone. And he requested me to do this since Mr. Marlowe had driven to Southampton for him in the motor. He said I was to take the message down if it came, but on no account was I to disturb him.
And that was all?
He ordered a fresh siphon of soda water.
Mm. You noticed nothing unusual about him? He didn't appear worried, ill at ease?
No, sir. When I answered his ring, he was seated by the telephone, and when I returned with the siphon, he was engaged in conversation over the wire.
Excuse me, sir.
What is it, Sergeant?
Dr. Stocks just sent something up for you, sir. Something private.
Ah, yes, right. Excuse me for a moment, Trent.
Yes, of course. To continue, do you remember anything of what Mr. Manderson was saying on the telephone?
Something about somebody being at some hotel.
Hmm. And that was the last you saw and heard of him alive?
No, sir. At about 11:30, I heard him go up to bed. I myself sat up till 12:30, as instructed, but no message came.
Sorry about that.
Oh, not at all. Martin, did you hear Mr. Manderson re-enter the house after returning from his drive in the car?
No, sir. His ringing the bell in this room was the first I knew of his being back. He must have come in by the French window.
If I may.
Inspector?
That does seem likely. There's a footprint in the soft new gravel just outside. It exactly matches the patent shoes Manderson wore that night.
I see.
And he still had his hat on, I remember, and had thrown his greatcoat over the end of that table where he'd placed a decanter of whiskey, a siphon and a glass. He kept them in that cupboard.
Hmm. Was he a heavy drinker?
Oh, on the contrary, sir. He was a remarkably abstemious man.
This cupboard?
Yes, that's right, sir.
Yes. About the whisky, did Mr. Manderson take a drink that night?
I couldn't say, sir. I know the decanter was nearly full that evening. I'd refilled it a day or so before.
It's half empty now.
How extraordinary.
Well, that's how it was this morning.
I don't understand it. Most days he never drank a drop.
The servants, perhaps?
Out of the question. The women servants never touch anything. I can answer for it. And when I want a drink, I can help myself without going to the decanter.
Thank you. Now, about Mr. Manderson's clothing. I suppose he had dressed for dinner that night?
Oh, certainly, sir. He had on a suit with a dress jacket, which he usually wore when dining at home.
And he was dressed like that when you saw him last?
All but the jacket, yes, sir. When he spent the evening in the library, as usually happened of late, he would change it for an old tweed shooting jacket. When I last saw him, he was wearing that.
I see. Now, to the following morning, I understand that Mr. Manderson was not missed until the body was found about 10:00.
That is so, sir. Mr. Manderson was never called in the morning, nor did he have anything brought up to him. And quite often he would sleep till 9 or 10 o'clock.
And you yourself heard nothing in the night? No pistol shot, no sounds of struggle?
Oddly enough, sir, nothing. I am a light sleeper, and my bedroom is on the side of the house nearest to where Mr. Manderson's body was found, but... No, I heard nothing.
Nor did you hear him leave the house at whatever time it was the following morning?
No, sir.
Hmm. One final question. Were the clothes in which the body was found the clothes which Mr. Manderson would naturally have worn that day?
Another oddity, sir. I must answer yes and no. The brown suit was one of a dozen he might have worn, but otherwise...
Yes?
Well, he had put on all the same things he had worn the night before. Large fronted shirt and all. It was quite unprecedented, and shows to my way of thinking what a hurry he must have been in when getting up, because normally...
Thank you. That is all for the moment. Though you can point us in the direction of Mr. Manderson's bedroom.
As you say, Murch, for the apartment of a plutocrat, it is strangely bare.
Yeah. It's all been left as it was on the morning the body was discovered.
Mm, indeed. Bed unmade.
Oh, teeth and a glass on the bedside table. Oh. Scattered articles of clothing. Dressing table in some disorder.
As you might expect of a man who was dressing in a hurry.
Mm. Now, where are these patent leather shoes you spoke of?
In this cupboard, sir, right hand side.
Mm. And these?
Are the offending articles. Manderson left them outside the door as usual for the maid to clean.
Mm, she didn't clean them all that well. Look, a faint trace of red gravel in the angle between the heel and the instep.
Yes, it matches the gravel outside the French window.
Where you found the footprint?
Correct.
Mm. That is strange.
What?
There's a slight split in the leather here, where the two laced parts of the shoe join the upper. Mm. Same in both shoes. Stitching is slightly parted.
Very slightly, yes.
Also, slight straining of the stitches where the uppers join the sole.
Well, as Martin said, he wore them every evening. You'd expect a certain amount of wear and tear.
Hmm, perhaps. Let's take a look next door.
Mm. It's another world in there.
Hmm. Well, the lady has taste. Mm. Now, this separating door, was it open the morning the body was found?
It was. let me just refer to my notes. Yes. The French maid Celestine brought up tea to Mrs. Manderson at about 7 o'clock as usual. Also, as usual, she shut the door between the two bedrooms so as not to disturb Monsieur.
So she came in from there and shut the door so, which means she couldn't see into her husband's room as she did so.
Correct. She could see nothing of the adjoining room. That is why it was assumed Manderson was still in his room while Mrs. Manderson was breakfasting, rising and performing her ablutions.
Did the maid also open the windows?
They were already open. Mrs. Manderson needed to sleep with plenty of fresh air. The maid merely opened the curtains.
Mm. Now, what sort of person is she, this maid?
French.
But a reliable witness.
No great ally of Mr. Manderson. She didn't like the way he'd been making her mistress unhappy. I don't regard her as a suspect, though.
Whom do you regard as a suspect, Inspector Murch?
If I'm pushed?
Mm-hmm.
Martin, the butler.
Ah.
At least as a preliminary theory. Now, as this. There's a plan of burglary. Say a couple of men in it and Martin squared. He's told them where the place is and all about the valuables in the drawing room and elsewhere. Martin leaves the French window in the library ajar, accidentally on purpose, and they walk in and sample the whiskey to give themselves Dutch courage. Now, Manderson isn't asleep yet, and hears them, thinks it's burglars, gets up very quietly to see if anything's wrong. He creeps down on them, they cut and run. He follows them, catches them up by the shed, there's a fight, one of them loses his head and makes a swinging job out of it. Now, you pick that to pieces.
Oh, very well. Just to oblige. First, no traces of burglars, and nobody hears anything of the stampede through the library or any shouts from Manderson inside or outside the house.
Oh, no.
Next, in your long experience, did you ever hear of a householder getting up in the night to pounce on burglars who dresses fully?
Oh.
Underclothes, shirt, collar and tie, trousers, waistcoat and coat, socks and hard leather shoes, gives the finishing touches to his toilet by fastidiously parting his hair.
Point
and
taken.
Putting on his watch and chain. Any item he seems to have forgotten was his teeth.
I did say it was only a preliminary theory.
Where do the two secretaries sleep?
Their rooms are directly opposite. I'll show you.
Thank you. Don't tell me this is John Marlowe's room.
Got it in one.
I haven't met Mr. Bunny yet, but I somehow don't see his room as being full of golf balls and fishing rods.
there's only one thing of interest. It's in that leather case.
This one?
Open it.
A revolver.
With the initials J.M. engraved on the stock. John Marlowe. Nothing. Take a look at this. Dr. Stock just had it sent over for me.
Is it the bullet?
Found lodged in the bone at the back of Manderson's skull.
Could it have come from this revolver?
It could indeed. I know about firearms, Mr. Trent, and I can categorically state that it was fired by a weapon of this make and caliber. These marks were made by the rifling of the barrel, a barrel exactly like this one, and there is no other revolver which marks the bullet just like this.
Hmm. This mystery is all wrong.
Now, let's see where we stand. Marlowe was...
in Southampton. Yes. Left about 10 o'clock and didn't return until many hours after the murder was committed.
You're sure?
Positive. I questioned him late last night. He arrived in Southampton about 6:30 on the Monday morning.
Now, is there any corroboration?
Oh, yes. I also wired our people in Southampton. Early this morning, I got this reply.
Thank you. Person answering description in motor answering description arrived Bedford Hotel here 6 a.m. today, gave name Marlowe. Later inquired at docks with passenger named Harris on Havre Ferry, repeatedly until about 1:15 p.m. Left soon afterwards in car. Company's agents informed berth was booked name Harris last week, but Harris not on boat. Signed Burke, Inspector.
You see? His own story borne out in every particular. Also, he sent a wire to Manderson. Harris not turned up. Missed boat, returning Marlowe. It was duly delivered here in the afternoon and placed among the dead man's letters. In due course, Marlowe arrived back here dog-tired and nearly fainted when informed of Manderson's death.
It was unlucky for Manderson that Marlowe left his revolver and cartridges about so carelessly, don't you think? Wasn't that rather throwing temptation in somebody's way?
Oh. I wouldn't attach too much importance to that revolver if I were you. It's common enough over here. Calvin C. Bunner, at your service.
How do you do?
In fact, Mr. Manderson had one just like it. I expect you are Mr. Trent.
That's quite right.
You thought I might have been eavesdropping, perhaps? No, sir. I just heard a word or two about the revolver, that's all. It's what we call a Little Arthur back home, and I dare say there are duplicates of it in 10,000 hip pockets this very minute. I consider it too light in the hand myself. I prefer something heavier. Feel that, Mr. Trent. Be careful. It's loaded.
Yes. Tell me, Mr. Bunner, did Mr. Marlowe have need of a revolver?
He bought it to please the old man. Manderson said it was ridiculous for a secretary of his to be without a pistol.
Oh, why do you think Manderson said that, Mr. Bunner? Did he feel threatened?
I believe he knew there was something coming to him, something he couldn't dodge.
Indeed.
There was a change in his manner these last few months. He was gloomy, sullen, as if he was everlastingly brooding over something bad, something he couldn't fix. Then a couple of weeks back, his self-restraint began to go. I'm the only man who knows it, but when he was alone with me in his office, if the least little thing went wrong, he'd fly off the handle. And this was a man who always kept himself well in hand. His calm was deadly. I never saw anything like it.
And nobody saw this side of him but you?
I guess not.
And you put all this down to some fear that somebody had designs on his life?
I do.
Who?
Oh, there was a whole crowd of dangerous men scattered up and down the states who had it in for him. I mean, take the Pennsylvania coal strike alone. There were 30,000 men who would have jumped at the chance of drilling a hole through the man who fixed it so they'd either starve or give in to his terms.
That was years ago.
So what? They've been known to dynamite a man in Idaho who'd done them dirt in New Jersey 10 years before. And the Atlantic's not going to stop them.
Hmm.
Well. Well, deeply obliged to you, Mr. Bunner. Your theory's perfectly rational and appears to fit the facts. Now, my stomach says it's lunchtime, and whatever you're doing now, Mr. Trent?
Oh, just looking at Mr. Marlowe's shoes.
What about them?
Oh, nothing. They're just half a size larger than Mr. Manderson's, that's all.
Oh.
That's all. Shall we make a move? It's about 2 o'clock.
10 a.m. in little old New York. And I hope we never see anything nearer hell than what's loose in Wall Street this minute.
Good morning, my dear Trent.
Ah, good morning, my dear Cobbles.
They said at reception that you were still at breakfast.
No, almost finished.
Are you coming to the inquest?
No, I think not. I've still some work to do at the house. Now, I have little doubt that the good Dr. Stock will bring in a verdict of murder by person or persons unknown.
Oh, definitely not suicide, then.
Oh, no. This was a premeditated crime, an extraordinarily cunning one at that.
Huh?
Well, I'm ready now. Shall we walk up to White Gables together?
Yes, by all means.
I'll just go and get my camera.
You haven't yet had occasion to speak to my niece?
No, not yet. I have observed her, though.
Oh?
Yes, on the cliff top this morning. I usually take a walk before breakfast. I suddenly became aware of a woman sitting nearby. her arms drawn up about her knees, her face full of some dream. She was dressed all in black, but with great taste. It could only have been Mrs. Manderson. The lady is astonishingly beautiful.
Yes, in mind as well as body. Ah, look, here she is. Let me introduce you properly. Mabel, my dear.
Good morning, Uncle. And this is Mr. Trent?
Yes. Good morning, Mrs. Manderson.
I wish you success with your investigations.
I thank you.
Do you think you will succeed?
Oh, yes. Yes, I believe so, Mrs. Manderson. But I may find it necessary to consult you before my conclusions are published.
Of course.
In fact, may I ask you a question or two now? Nothing, I think, that you would rather not answer.
The inquest, Trent, that will be ordeal enough.
Uncle, I don't mind. Ask your questions, Mr. Trent.
Thank you. Your husband had in his desk an unusually large sum of ready money. Have you any idea why?
I can't imagine. But I'm very surprised to hear it.
Why surprised?
I thought my husband had very little money in the house. Because on Sunday night, just before he and Mr. Marlowe went out in the car, he came into the drawing room and asked if I could let him have some money until the next day. I gave him all I had in the house. It was about £30. He put it in his pocket.
He did not tell you why he wanted it?
No. He seemed to be irritated about something and said he hoped a drive in the car by moonlight might help him sleep. I remember thinking it odd that he should want money on a Sunday night. He usually kept about £100 by him. But I didn't pursue the matter. I'd forgotten all about it.
It was curious, certainly. Mrs. Manderson, when your husband went to bed that night, were you still awake?
Oh, no, I dozed off. I was half aroused by the light going on in the adjoining room. I was very drowsy, but I believe I asked what time it was and if he'd enjoyed his drive in the car.
And what time was it?
Oh, 11:30, he said. His usual bedtime. And he said he'd changed his mind about the drive.
Did he say why?
Yes. He said he'd sent Mr. Marlowe to Southampton to bring back some important information from a man who was leaving for Paris by the next day's boat. He said Marlowe could do the journey quite easily if he had no accident. Then he explained that he'd gone with Marlowe for a mile or so, and then walked home, and that he felt all the better for it. He was most forthcoming. Unusually so.
Which brings us, I fear, to a more painful subject.
Yes?
Your relations with your husband.
Oh, Trent, I beg of you.
It's all right, Uncle. I'm sure the subject will come up at the inquest.
Oh, very well.
During the last few months of my husband's life, he changed towards me. And his attitude gave me great anxiety and sorrow. He'd become very reserved, mistrustful. He avoided my company.
And you?
Tried to work against it. Did all I could, with justice to my own dignity.
And you never asked him what was wrong?
No. I only made a point of being to him exactly as I had always been, so far as he'd allow me.
There were never any words between you?
Never. Hmm. Now, if that is all, I think we should be leaving, Uncle, if you'd give me your arm.
Yes.
Are you coming with us, Mr. Trent?
No, Trent isn't attending the court, Mabel. He's continuing his investigations here at the house.
Ah.
I'll see you later, Trent.
Yes.
Come along, my dear.
That is a wonderful woman, Mr. Trent.
Yes, indeed. Apropos of nothing in particular, were you at Oxford, Mr. Marlowe?
Yes. Why?
Just a guess. Who's Harris?
Harris? Oh, nobody knows, not even Banner. All I know is that when I was in London last week, I booked a deck cabin at Mr. Manderson's request for a Mr. George Harris on the boat that sailed on Monday.
And your errand to Southampton?
Manderson said he simply wanted me to find Harris and bring back a message from him. I was further told that Harris mightn't turn up. If he did, every moment was of importance.
But wasn't it an extraordinary thing to send you dashing off like that in the middle of the night?
It was about 10:00, to be exact. Not that I'd have been surprised if he'd roused me out of my bed at midnight. Manderson had a taste for the dramatic. He'd suddenly decided that he wanted to have word from this man Harris. I accepted it, and that was that.
Why should he then have told Mrs. Manderson you were taking him for a midnight run?
I've no idea.
And Martin was told the same thing.
You know as much as I do, Mr. Trent. He came with me for a short way, then walked back. I drove on to Southampton. Mm.
Now, if you'll excuse me, it's time I was going to the inquest.
One thing more, Mr. Marlowe.
Yes?
Just look at these. Closely, if you please.
They come from a diary, don't they? From the October pages for this year. There's no writing on them.
Have you ever seen them before?
No. To my knowledge, nobody here has any such diary. Ah, telegraph.
Are you the gentleman, Mr. Trent?
Yes, I am.
Telegram for you, sir.
Oh, thank you. Uh-huh.
It must be good news.
Not exactly news, Mr. Marlowe. It tells me only that another little guess of mine was right.
Yes? Ah, oh, couples. Come on in.
Thank you.
How did the inquest go?
Murder by person or persons unknown, as you expected.
Did Dr. Stock pass an opinion on the time of death?
He did. 6 to 8 hours before the finding of the body, based on rigor mortis. Why?
Well, to begin with, there are things that may hasten or retard the cooling of a body. Huh? This one was lying in long dewy grass on the shady side of a shed. As for rigidity, if Manderson died in a struggle or labouring under a sudden emotion, his corpse might stiffen practically instantaneously, particularly where there's damage to the skull. On the other hand, stiffening might not have begun until 8 or 10 hours after death. Excuse me.
Oh, sorry.
I want to get to the light.
Yes,
thank you.
What are you doing?
However, what we can say is this. He wasn't shot at a time when people were awake, say after 6:30 a.m. And since Martin sat up until about 12:30, that leaves us with about 6 hours during which the crime could have been committed. Unless...
Unless what?
Yes. This is a pretty good negative. Washed enough now, I think. Let's leave it to dry and get rid of all this mess.
What is all this?
Oh, it's called a hypo-eliminator. It's very useful when you're in a hurry with a negative. Did you know there's a very good dark room downstairs?
Trent, please tell me, what is going on?
Would you like to see a little bit of high-class police work? Now, just getting to the interesting bit, as you came in.
Well, yes,
now, can you, without touching it, tell me what this is?
Yes, of course I can. It's a small glass bowl. It looks like an ordinary finger bowl.
Right. Now, take this bottle, pull out the cork.
Right.
Excellent. Do you recognize the powder inside?
No.
You swallowed pounds of it in your time. They give it to babies. No?
Yeah.
Well, it's a grey powder, is its ordinary name. Mercury and chalk. Oh, it's splendid stuff. Now, pour a little of the powder over this part of the glass bowl.
Huh?
Good. I can see you've done this before.
I haven't, I assure you. It's all a complete mystery to me.
Now, I dust the powdered part of the bowl lightly with this camel hair brush. And what do you see?
2 large grey finger marks on the bowl. They weren't there before.
Allow me to explain. The human hand, even when quite clean, is never quite dry. And sometimes, in moments of anxiety, for instance, it's very moist. And when you pick up an object, like a finger bowl, you leave traces upon it which are practically invisible. That bowl was picked up by somebody with a rather moist hand, and quite recently, too. Now, if we sprinkle some of the powder on the outside of the bowl, so... the thumb mark comes to light. This is of the index finger, a single spiral whorl with deltas symmetrically disposed, and this, the print of the second finger, is a simple loop with a staple core and 15 counts. How do I know there are 15, you ask?
Well,
because I have the same 2 prints on this negative, which I've examined in detail. See for yourself. See the bifurcation of that ridge? Well, there it is in the other. See that little scar near the center? Well, there it is again.
Yes, I see.
They were clearly made by the same hand.
Oh, without doubt. Where did you photograph them?
On the inside of the left-hand leaf of the front window in Mrs. Manderson's bedroom. The bowl comes from Manderson's room. It contained his false teeth.
Then, presumably, they are Manderson's finger marks.
I wonder. Shall we see if we can match them once more? I believe we can.
Now what?
Lamp black. Now, do you know what this is?
Yes, a blank page from a diary.
My diary, to be precise. October. Right. Take the page in these tweezers.
Oh, okay.
I'll sprinkle some of the lamp black onto the surface of the paper. So. Now the other side. So. And there. Clearly printed in black.
The same two prints we saw on the bowl and the photographic negative.
Same man, you see. Well, couples, now I know. Now I know.
Well, I'm still completely in the dark.
Why don't we go for a walk along the beach, my friend? I'll tell you the painful truth.
It all began with the shoes.
Whose shoes?
A pair of Manderson's, black patent leather. He'd been wearing them the evening before he died.
Well, what about them?
Stitching was split in such a way as to make me believe the shoes had been worn by someone for whom they were slightly too small.
But why should anyone wear them?
That is precisely what I ask myself, Cuffles. And suddenly, ideas rearranged themselves in my mind, and I found solutions to problems which had previously baffled me.
Mm-hmm. Such as?
Why was Manderson so untidily dressed when the body was found? Why were the cuffs dragged up inside the sleeves of the jacket? Why was his watch in the wrong pocket of his waistcoat? Why was he not wearing his false teeth? And more, why wasn't he heard as he left the house that morning? Why did nobody hear the struggle and the shot? I'll tell you why. It was not Manderson who was in the house that night.
Oh, but that's absurd.
Is it?
Well, people saw him at close quarters.
Oh, but did they? Mrs. Manderson spoke to him as he went to bed. Indeed, found him strangely forthcoming. But she never actually saw him, because the open door connecting her bedroom with his would have hidden him from her view.
Martin saw him. He said so at the inquest.
Martin thought he saw him. What in fact he saw was a man wearing Manderson's smoking jacket and broad-brimmed hat, hunched over a telephone.
He spoke to him.
Oh, yes, he did. Which gives us clues as to the man's identity. One, he was sufficiently closely connected to the dead man to be able to deceive both Martin and Mrs. Manderson. Two, he was roughly Manderson's build, though his feet were slightly larger. Three, he was a good actor and mimic. And four, he had a minute acquaintance with the ways of the household.
But why? Whoever he is, should he go through with this charade?
Because it was necessary for him to create the belief that Sigsby Manderson was alive and in the house until sometime after midnight that Sunday.
And he wasn't?
No. Manderson was dead before the false Manderson came to the house.
Am I to conclude from this that you believe the false Manderson to be our murderer?
Mm. And a very cool customer into the bargain. He shoots Manderson, probably at some distance from the house.
Yeah, which would account for nobody hearing the shot.
Dumps the body by the shed, puts on Manderson's outer garments, and removes Manderson's false teeth. He then walks quietly to the house, ensuring that he makes clear footprints in the gravel of the path. On reaching the library, he helps himself to a stiff whiskey.
Well, that's hardly surprising.
He rings for Martin, successfully passing himself off as the man's employer. Oh. Then he shuts himself up in Manderson's bedroom and prepares convincing evidence of its having been occupied by Manderson himself. He places the shoes outside the bedroom door, throws Manderson's outer garments over a chair, puts the denture in the bowl by the bedside, selects a suit, a pair of shoes, and a tie from Manderson's wardrobe. While he's doing this, he hears the sound that he's dreading most, the drowsy voice in the adjoining room. Once again, as with Martin, he successfully mimics Manderson's voice and then settles down until he's sure Mabel Manderson is sleeping soundly. He then leaves the house on tiptoe by way of Mrs. Manderson's window, knowing that Martin will be alert and on duty downstairs, awaiting the expected telephone call.
That doesn't make sense, Trent. It was the impostor himself who instructed Martin to wait out. Now, why?
He needed an alibi.
Marlowe? Oh, not Marlowe.
Oh, yes. John Marlowe's presence in Southampton at 6:30 the following morning provided an airtight alibi only if the murder was assumed to be committed sometime after 12:30. It would be physically impossible for the car, a 15-horsepower four-cylinder Northumberland, to get to Southampton by 6:30 unless it left Marlston by midnight at the latest.
So Marlowe quietly leaves the house by way of my niece's window, dresses Manderson's body in the brown suit he's taken from the wardrobe,
making several crucial mistakes in the process,
and drives off at high speed to Southampton.
Precisely.
There could be no doubt about it, I suppose.
Unfortunately, none. The fingerprints on the glass bowl and on the window are definitely Marlowe's. Also, I sent a telegram to a personal friend who's a fellow of a college at Oxford, asking if John Marlowe had any connections with acting while at the university.
And?
I received his reply this morning. Marlowe was a member of the Oxford University Dramatic Society for 3 years, played Bardolph, Cleon and Mercutio, excelled in character acting and imitations, and was the hero of some famous hoaxes.
Conclusive, then?
I think so.
And his motive for murdering Manderson?
Remains to be seen.
Trent, what do you intend to do?
The first thing must be to write all this up for the newspaper. And then...
Yes?
And then I must nerve myself for what may prove to be a most distressful interview.
Good morning, Mr. Trent.
Good morning.
Please, do come in and sit down.
Thank you.
You look wretchedly tired.
I've been working half the night on my final report to the Record, and thinking hard for the rest.
Your final report?
I have it here, in this envelope.
You know the identity of the murderer?
Oh, yes.
Well, then...
Mrs. Manderson, forgive me, but first, may I ask you some further questions?
Oh, yes. Yes, of course.
Is it true that you have no idea why your late husband changed his attitude to you?
I've told you so already, Mr. Trent. And I said so again at the inquest.
I do not believe you.
You're accusing me of perjury?
I am accusing you of not telling the whole truth. I need to know.
Very well. The whole truth, however painful. Our marriage wasn't a very successful one. I was only 20. He was the only strong man I had ever known. But it didn't take me long to realize that he cared more for his business than he did for me. His main purpose in marrying me, I think, was to have at his side a wife who would take an important place in society, do credit to his position in the world. And I found I couldn't.
Please continue.
Can you think what it means to step out of a world where there was always some creative work in the background? Work with some dignity about it. Men and women with professions or arts to follow, ideals to believe in. Some of them wealthy, some of them poor. Can you think what it means to step out of that world into another where you have to be rich, shamefully rich, to exist at all? Where money is the only thing that counts, and the women live for display and silly amusements and silly immoralities. It was so empty. I did try to adjust. I went on trying. And I never told him how I felt. But I was a total failure. I used to steal holidays now and then, and with old school friends, perhaps, who couldn't afford to travel. Or I'd stay in London quietly with people who'd known me all my life, and we'd tell each other about cheap dressmakers and sit in cheap seats at the theatre. They were my happiest times.
And your husband discovered this?
It happened last year. I don't know how. Some woman may have suggested it to him, because the women all understood, of course. Anyway, he said nothing to me, but I sensed that he knew, and after a while, we were just being polite and considerate to each other, and I felt the whole basis of our living together was going under my feet. Then at last it was gone.
And that is the whole truth?
Yes. You still don't believe me?
Oh, I want to.
But?
I have to ask you one last brutal question.
Yes?
Mrs. Manderson, will you solemnly assure me that your husband's change towards you had nothing to do with jealousy towards John Marlowe?
Oh.
I need your assurance, Mrs. Manderson. That is all I wanted to know. I'll leave my manuscript on the table. Do what you like with it. As far as I'm concerned, the case is closed. I'm deeply sorry.
My dear Cupples, I have cut and run. What else could I do? I love your niece. I've loved her from the first moment I saw her. She's all you said of her and more, much more. I'd resolved at our first meeting to take you every step of the way, and I'll do so now, even though it causes us both pain. You asked about Marlowe's motive. It was love. His love for Mabel Manderson.
Obsessed by his passion for her, and witnessing every day the evidence of her unhappiness, he planned and then performed Manderson's murder. Murder, for a woman's sake, is, heaven knows, not all that rare a crime. But it needed all his intelligence and all his daring. Did it also require your niece's complicity? That is the dread question I've asked myself a thousand times. Did she know the murder was brewing and keep silent? Or worse, did she plan it with him, assist him in his escape through her bedroom window? Was she even the ruling spirit in the crime? I fancy not. In her presence, I have felt an inward certainty of her ultimate goodness of heart. I can believe that in her destitution she turned to that graceful and handsome young man, but I cannot believe that she had any knowledge of his deadly purpose. You know her better than I do. I am sure you will believe the same. I have left my manuscript with her to do with as she wishes, and I have returned Sir James's check. In the circumstances, it seemed the only honourable thing to do. I see no chance of anybody else hitting on the solution to the crime, so it is our secret alone, and I have no doubt that you will share my wish that it remain so. I must try to get her out of my mind, so I have asked Sir James to send me somewhere, anywhere, as the Record's own correspondent. I leave tomorrow for Curland and Livonia to cover the revolt. They say time heals. I hope and pray it may be so.
Goodbye, my dear old friend. Yours, I, Philip Trent.
It isn't Mr. Trent.
What?
Good day to you, sir.
Mr. Bunner.
Yes, sir. Calvin C. Bunner at your service.
What are you doing in Paris?
Well, sir, I am now resident here as the chief continental agent of the Madison Company and fully satisfied with that position and its prospects. I may add that life is a great deal quieter now I'm no longer at Madison's beck and call 24 hours a day. No disrespect to the deceased intended. And what brings you to Paris, Mr. Trent?
I'm working for the Record full-time these days. I don't seem able to paint. I've not been in England for a year, as a matter of fact. I have quite lost touch.
Is it a year since the murder? My.
Tell me, whatever became of Manderson's other secretary, John Marlowe?
Oh, I can bring you right up to date with John. We're in constant contact, and we're even planning a holiday together this summer. That's if he can tear himself away from his fiancée.
He's engaged to be married?
That's right. A lovely girl. Irish. She'll make him a wonderful wife. John's running his father's business these days and really putting it on the map. He has a fine head on his shoulders, and when he's gotten himself more experience, he'll be up there with the smartest in the land. Mr. Trent, you still with me?
I'm sorry. I thought...
You thought what?
No matter. Mr. Bunner.
Yeah?
What news of Mrs. Manderson?
Oh, can't help you much there, I'm afraid. She left England immediately after the settlement of her husband's affairs, and I believe she lived for some time in Florence, Italy.
Is she still there, do you know?
No, I believe she returned to London, sold up the house in Mayfair, and bought a smaller one out Hampstead way, where she lives quietly alone, hardly venturing into society. Seems a crime, doesn't it? All those good hard dollars just waiting for someone to spraddle them around.
So she was a beneficiary under Manderson's will?
Oh, I'll say. He left her more than half his wad. Why, she has money to burn. Just think of the fear she might make in the world. But nothing doing. Do you know, Mr. Trent, she is the best woman I ever met. But she just could never seem to get the habit of spending money. Mr. Trent, are you still with me?
Forgive me. I can already see the white cliffs above Dover.
You're returning to London?
At once. Thank you, Mr. Bummer.
What for?
Everything.
Yes, yes, I'm coming. Burton Cupples.
Hello, Cupples. It's Philip Trent.
My dear boy, where are you speaking from?
I'm back in London.
Welcome home.
Cupples, I need to speak to your niece.
Aha.
I think we should meet in private and alone.
Oh, do you not?
I realize it's presumption on my part approaching you after what I said about Mabel in my letter. You'd be fully entitled to refuse me, but it is desperately important to me, and we've been friends for a long time.
There's no need to be abject, dear boy. I'll get her to invite you to tea.
Mrs. Manderson, may I say something?
Please do.
It is about what occurred at our last meeting. Do you remember?
I shall never forget.
Well, I owe you an apology. I realize now that what I thought about you was not true.
No.
And I cannot imagine how such suspicions could ever have entered my head.
There's no need to apologize. You were right up to a point.
How?
I can see now that my late husband's actions that night, his attitude towards me during the last few months of his life, were prompted by jealousy towards John Marlowe, as you suspected.
But quite without reason.
I've thought about it a great deal. And all I can think of are little things. For instance, one day he asked me what I most liked about Mr. Marlowe, and I said, his manners. And he gave me a black look and said, yes, Marlowe is a gentleman, not looking at me. Then a while later, Mr. Marlowe fell in love with Alice, an American girl who was the most unprincipled flirt I ever knew. She made a complete fool of him. So, one day, I asked him to row me in a boat on the lake. And in the boat, I told him the truth about Alice. He took it admirably, but didn't believe me a bit. Anyway, when we got back, my husband helped me out of the boat, and though he joked at the time, he was reserved and silent that evening. And he looked so wretched the next day at breakfast that I thought he was ill. Soon after, Mr. Marlowe showed me a note that he'd received from Alice, asking him for his congratulations on her engagement. He was deeply upset. I put my hand on his arm just as my husband came into the room. He looked at us and turned and walked quietly back into his study. He then went away for a week on business, and when he returned, he was looking white and strange, and as soon as he saw me, he asked where Mr. Marlowe was. I should have realized the truth then, but I didn't.
And that is all there was between you?
Yes. Mr. Marlowe's a little younger than I am, and for all his cleverness, I looked on him practically as a boy. He was so vulnerable, so amiable, so lacking in ambition. I felt protective towards him, as one might towards a younger brother. And that, at last, is the whole truth.
You see before you a man dressed in the scrubbiest sackcloth made and daubed with the grittiest ashes. But I do have one more question.
Ask it by all means.
You have my manuscript incriminating Mr. Marlowe. Why have you never used it?
Because I know he's innocent.
Innocent? But all the evidence...
Evidence of what? He impersonated my husband that night, escaped by my bedroom window and thereby established an alibi. I don't see those things can be doubted, but that's all. I knew Mr. Marlowe constantly for several years, and I know him to be incapable of a crime of bloodshed. He hated physical violence. It would be impossible for him deliberately to take another man's life.
It is still conceivable he killed by accident or in self-defense.
Yes. I've thought it over till my head ached and I can see no solution to the mystery. All I am clear about is that John Marlowe isn't a murderer, and that if it ever came to court, the judge and jury would probably think he was. So I've simply let it alone.
There's only one thing for it. I must see Marlowe. Do you know where I might find him?
No. But I dare say Uncle Burton could tell you. He met Mr. Marlowe a while ago in London and they talked. Personally, I never saw him again after you left White Gables. Though I'm sure you'll have assumed otherwise. What did you suppose had happened to Mr. Marlowe after you had withdrawn from the scene?
I supposed that you would have married him and gone to live abroad.
In genteel poverty?
I beg your pardon?
Mr. Marlowe had no money then. And under the terms of the will, if I marry again, I lose everything my husband left me.
I had no idea.
On the whole, I'm glad of it. For one thing, it spared me from a good many attentions of a kind a woman in my position frequently has to put up with.
And the other kind?
Ah, trouble me even less. I haven't yet met a man silly enough to want to marry a widow with luxurious habits and tastes and very little money.
Haven't you, by heaven? Then I'm going to show you that human passion is not always stifled by the smell of money. I am not afraid to make a fool of myself. Look at me. It is the sight of the century. It is one who says he loves you and would ask you to give up very great wealth to stand at his side. You have never been out of my thoughts since the time I first saw you. It was only your beauty that filled my mind then, but later I came to know your stronger magic, and it has been with me ever since.
Oh, Mr. Trent, please stop. Where is your self-restraint?
Gone. Gone. It has got right away. I am going after it in a minute. I don't care so much now. I love you, honor you, hold you dearest of all the world. There. I have finished. Now you give me leave to go.
No, Philip. I very much want you to stay.
How do you suppose he'll receive us?
Well, couples, that rather depends.
You still think he's guilty, don't you? I'm sure he isn't.
And so is Mabel.
He had no motive, did he? It was all in Manderson's mind.
Well, he still has a number of questions to answer.
Mr. Trent, Mr. Couples.
Good evening, Mr. Marlowe.
Please come through, both of you.
Please make yourselves comfortable.
Thank you,
Mr. Marlowe.
Are you here as a witness, Mr. Couples, or merely moral support?
As an interested party, Mr. Marlowe, nothing more.
You've read Mr. Trent's manuscript.
Yes, I'm aware of its contents.
Mr. Couples and I discussed the matter fully before I left Marlstone.
I've read it three times. It's an astonishing document, Mr. Trent. You've got at so much of the truth.
Thank you. There are still some pieces missing, which we are looking to you to provide.
In my own defense?
Listen, I still have no reason to doubt the conclusions I came to regarding the events of that night and your involvement in them. You wore Manderson's shoes, you impersonated his voice, you made your escape through the window of Mrs. Manderson's bedroom, all in a determined attempt to establish an alibi. Why?
Let me tell you the facts of what happened that night. Bunner and I dined with the Mandersons, rising from the table at about 9. Then Mrs. Manderson retired to the drawing room. Bunner went to visit a friend, and Manderson led me to the orchard behind the house, saying he wished to have a talk. He said there was a big thing on, and he wanted me to do him an important service.
Please continue.
Manderson asked me if I remembered the name George Harris. Yes, I said. On your instructions, I booked a cabin in that name on the boat that leaves Southampton at noon tomorrow. Whereupon he took the ticket from his wallet, handed it to me, and said, George Harris cannot leave England tomorrow. You must go in his place. I'm here to obey orders, I said. Yes, he said, but these aren't ordinary orders.
Mm-hmm.
The point is this. The deal I'm busy with will be ruined if anybody's aware of my involvement. So if my secretary is known to have crossed to Paris at this time, the game is up. Rather grudgingly, I agreed to do my best to conceal my identity. He then gave me a list of complicated instructions. What they amounted to was this. I was to take the car and set off for Southampton immediately, since no train would fit in. Once in Southampton, at about 6 the following morning, I was to proceed to the Bedford Hotel and inform Harris, if he was there, that I was to go to Paris in his stead.
And if he wasn't?
Well, that meant that he'd received Manderson's telegram and the plan would proceed without him. I was to leave the car at a garage under an assumed name, change my appearance, and travel by the boat as George Harris. In Paris, I was to take a room at the Hotel St. Petersburg, where I would, in the course of time, receive a message addressed to George Harris instructing me where to take a locked wallet which Manderson was going to give me.
And all this in the strictest secrecy?
Absolutely. Anyway, I threw a few necessaries into a suitcase and rejoined him in the library, where he handed me a stout leather letter case, about 8 inches by 6, fastened with a strap and with a lock on it. It just fitted into my side pocket. I was about to leave when I realized I only had a few shillings in my pocket. I suppose I should explain. I'd been keeping myself short of cash because, well, I'd been speculating, particularly on Wall Street, and, as Bunner put it, I'd been separated from my role.
You'd lost all your money?
The lot. And on that fatal Sunday night, Manderson knew that I was perfectly penniless. You should bear that fact in mind. Anyway, back to the story. I went to Manderson and asked for expenses for the journey. Immediately his hand went towards his hip pocket, where he usually kept a little case containing about £100. Then suddenly he checked and swore under his breath. I assumed that he'd mislaid his note case and reminded him that he had in his desk £1,000 in small notes, which I'd drawn for him. I suggested he should take my expenses out of that.
Yes.
He looked at me with such fury on his face, such hatred in his eyes. Then he said he'd get some money and I was to wait in the car. My mind was in turmoil. I'd never seen him behave like that before, though Bunner had told me of his sudden outbursts when they were alone.
So what did you do?
I stepped out onto the lawn and paced up and down, smoking a cigarette. Presently, I passed close to one of the drawing-room windows, and I noticed Mrs. Manderson's shadow on the thin silk curtain. Well, the window was open, and I heard her asking Manderson if £30 would be enough. He said it would do, and I heard the chink of money. Then he said, and I remember his words exactly, he said, "I'm going out now. Marlowe has persuaded me to go for a moonlight run in the car. He says it'll help me sleep."
Your errand was secret. He told a little lie.
But Manderson never lied, even on the most insignificant matter. And yet what had I just heard? A voluntary statement that was totally false. I was suddenly on my guard. My mind was racing. Why did he tell that lie? What had he done with the money? Why wasn't it in his desk? Gentlemen, I believe that lie saved me from being hanged as his murderer.
Continue, please.
I stepped quickly to the car, where Manderson handed me a little under £30. He got in, and we drove off towards Bishopsbridge. At the gate to the golf course, a mile or so from the house, he said he would get out. I stopped the car. He asked me to repeat the instructions he'd given me. I did so. He said, "Goodbye, then, and stay with that wallet." I drove off, looking in the mirror as I did so. In it, for a moment, I saw Manderson's face, clear in the moonlight. It was the face of a triumphant madman. It was suddenly clear to me that he hated me insanely and was gloating over me, driving away to my fate.
And to what did you attribute this sudden hatred?
I've no idea. I still haven't. Who can plumb the depths of a madman's delusion?
You are convinced he was insane?
Oh, Mr. Trent, what sane man takes his own life to deliver someone he hates to the hangman?
You are saying that Manderson was responsible for his own death?
I am.
But there were no powder burns. And why
Suppose we have the story first, my dear chap, and discuss the details later.
Yes, of course. Of course, forgive me. Mr. Marlowe, please proceed.
There's a sharp bend in the road about 300 yards from where I set Manderson down, and once I was out of his sight, I stopped the car and got out. I suddenly knew where the money was, £1,000. It was in my pocket. The whole Paris business was a blind.
Yes! of course, I see.
Manderson would return to the house, phone the police, and tell them I'd taken his car and some money and was attempting to escape the country. They'd catch up with me in Paris if I got that far.
Living under a false name.
Wearing a disguise.
Having garaged the car under a false name.
And having travelled on the ferry in a cab in which I had booked in advance, also under a false name.
The crime of a man who was desperately short of money.
And I was desperately short of money, and Manderson knew it.
Ingenious.
I took the letter case from my pocket, tore the staple out of the lock, and examined the contents in the headlights of the car.
Yes, Manderson's note case, £1,000, and two small wash leather bags containing uncut diamonds.
Exactly.
Good grief.
I knew instantly what I had to do. I turned the car, intending to catch up with Manderson before he reached the house and to tell him to his face what I thought of him. I was already travelling fast towards White Gables when I heard a shot in front of me and to the right. My first wild thought was that Manderson was shooting at me, and then I realised that the noise hadn't been close at hand, and I could see nobody in spite of the bright moonlight. As I reached the gate where I'd set Manderson down, I saw him. He was lying dead on the turf, clearly visible, just inside the gate.
On the golf course?
Obviously. The eighth green is just there.
Yes, he was on the green. Quite close to the flag, his arms stretched out, And his eye. Well, you know, you saw it.
Yes.
Close by lay his soft black hat, and at his feet was what I soon identified as my revolver. For a few seconds I sat there helplessly staring at the body. Then I realized the appalling danger I was in. It wasn't prison Manderson had planned for me, but the scaffold. Yes. Do you play chess, Mr. Trent?
Yes, I do. Why?
I've played since I was a boy, and I'm pretty good. Manderson and I would play most evenings. He was brilliant. He planned his financial coups rather like a chess game and was a master of the unexpected. It occurred to me that he must have planned his death like a chess game too, and that I must now do likewise if I wanted to get out of my predicament with a whole skin. And gradually the whole strange plan fell into place.
Were you so confident that you could imitate Manderson's voice?
Oh, I'd done it before and fooled Banner.
It took great courage all the same.
I just needed to remain calm.
So you loaded the body into the car, drove back to White Gables and deposited him by the shed.
That's right. Then I put on his hat and outer garments.
Including the shoes.
Yes. They were painful all the time I wore them, but I knew that no footstep of mine must appear on the soft ground between the hut and the house. Mm. So I crammed my feet into them and just got on with the job. The rest, I think, you know.
It must have been a horrible business, dressing and undressing the body.
Yes. The worst part was getting his teeth out. But I was wriggling my head out of a noose. I knew it had to be done. Unfortunately, in my hurry, it seems I forgot to pull down his cuffs and put his watch in the wrong pocket, but I needed to get away if I was to be in Southampton by 6. And it was on that my alibi depended.
I think the occasional mistake is understandable given the circumstances. You'd drunk a fair amount of whiskey, too.
Oh, no, you're wrong about that. I'd had one stiff one, that's all. I poured the rest into a flask for the journey.
Ah.
I knew how important it was that I kept a clear head. There were so many things to do.
Indeed, you needed to clean the revolver and return it to your own room.
Replace the money and the diamonds in the desk.
Take off the shoes and place them outside Manderson's bedroom door.
Select a suit, tie and shoes for the body. Put his teeth in the bowl.
Leaving fingerprints as you did so.
Yes, yes.
Tumble the bed and make it look as if it had been slept in. And all this with Mrs. Manderson in the adjoining room.
Your worst moment must surely have been when she spoke.
Oh, yes, indeed. I knew it was a possibility, but I nearly lost my nerve all the same.
What I don't understand is why you needed to leave the house by way of her window. There were other rooms which were empty on that side of the house where there was little chance of being seen by Martin or by anybody else.
Oh, I hadn't the nerve. When I entered Manderson's room, I seemed to shut the door on half my terrors.
But what if Mrs. Manderson had remained awake?
I hoped and prayed she wouldn't. I knew her to be a sound sleeper. It seemed a reasonable risk to take. And I hadn't anticipated at that point that by using her window I would be laying her open to the charge of complicity in Manderson's murder. I'd have done anything rather than that. Well, gentlemen, that's my story.
Hmm. Well, Trent, are you satisfied?
Fully.
Well, let's go, then. We've taken up enough of Mr. Marlowe's time. Goodbye, Marlowe.
Mr. Cobbles.
For my part, I never thought you guilty for a moment.
Oh, thank you.
Goodbye, Marlowe. Oh, one last question.
Yes?
Suppose someone else had been put on trial for the murder?
I'd have taken my story to the lawyers for the defense and put myself in their hands.
Well, there's no chance of that now, I think. I was talking to Inspector Mertz at Scotland Yard this morning. There isn't a shred of evidence against anyone. The official view is that it was a case of revenge by some American Black Hand gang. So, that is the end of that. Mr. Marlowe, I am a man who has worked hard to put a rope around your neck. Will you shake hands? Thank you. Come along, Cobbles. You are dining with me.
This is all very luxurious, Trent.
I come here only on special occasions. They do a saddle of mutton that's beyond compare.
Oh. And what are we celebrating this evening? The satisfactory conclusion to the Manderson affair?
No. No. This evening we are celebrating the fact that Mabel and I are to be married.
Oh, my dear friend.
friend. That is excellent news. Oh, I congratulate you from the bottom of my heart.
Thank you.
May I say how earnestly I've hoped for this ever since receiving your letter. Mabel has seen so much unhappiness, but, oh, she'll make you a simply glorious wife.
I am sure of it. Now, what are we to drink? The wine here?
No, I think I'll have a milk and soda water.
What? A couple's not so loud. The waiter has a weak heart.
However, you order the wine by all means to mark the occasion, and I'll have a sip of yours.
As you wish. As you wish. Well, my dear friend, it's been an extraordinary case.
Yes, indeed.
Though one small detail of it still puzzles me.
What's that?
The marks on Manderson's wrists. I imagine he did it himself to suggest...
No. No, Trent. They happened in the struggle.
Struggle? What struggle?
When I was trying to wrest the gun from his hand.
You?
Yes. I shot Sigsbee Manderson.
What?
It wasn't murder. On that night, I was taking my bedtime constitutional at about 10:15. I was nearly opposite the gate by the 8th hole on the golf course on the field path that runs behind White Gables when I heard a car coming. Then I heard it stop. I saw Manderson get out.
Yes?
As the car drove off again, to my great amazement, I saw him violently shake his fist at it. Then he went through the gate to the golf course and stood quite still on the 8th green. For a few moments he stood there with his head bent. Then his hand went to the pocket of his overcoat and he took out a revolver, which he held to his chest. I saw his face in the moonlight, and I knew at once he was insane.
You think he intended suicide?
Well, that's what I thought at the time. Perhaps he was only planning to wound himself. I don't know. Anyway, almost before I knew what I was doing, I leapt out of the shadows and seized his arm. He threw me off and pointed the gun at my head.
Good heavens.
And I managed to seize his wrist and hung on, fighting for my life. Somehow I tore the gun from his fingers. I never dreamt I had so much strength. And I retreated a few steps. And he sprang for my throat. I fired blindly in his face. His knees gave way and he fell in a heap on the turf. I flung the revolver down and bent over him. He was already dead. It was then that I heard the car returning. I hid.
You saw John Marlowe get out?
The whole time he was pacing up and down the green, I was within a few yards of him. I dare not show myself. I quarreled with Manderson that morning in public in front of the hotel. I was bound to be suspected. Assuming that Marlowe would immediately call for the police and that they would think it a case of suicide, I dashed back to the hotel, climbed in through a rear window, and I ordered myself a cup of cocoa.
Oh, my dear old friend. Why on earth didn't you tell me this before?
I would have. I was on the point of doing so when you told me you suspected Marlowe, but...
But what?
Your case against him had been put together so ingeniously, I simply didn't have the heart. I resolved to make a clean breast of it in the following morning, but by then, you'd gone. Your letter clearly stated that you intended to take no further action in the case, so I let sleeping dogs lie. However, you do have my abject apologies and my assurance that if Marlowe had had to face charges, I had to come forward straight away.
Oh, Couples. I am cured. You've beaten me. I shall never touch a crime mystery again. The Manderson affair will be Philip Trent's last case. Oh, there's just one thing I insist on.
What's that?
You shall pay for dinner.
Trent's Last Case by E.C. Bentley, the cast was Philip Trent, Martin Jarvis. Mabel Manderson, Helena Breck. Marlowe, Simon Hewitt. Bunner, Brian Hewlett. And Couples, Manning Wilson. Inspector Murch, Alan Downer. Martin, Stephen Thorne. Sir James Molloy, Sean Barrett. And Mrs. Morgan, Joanna Wake. Figgis, Paul Gregory. Edison, David Goodland. Williams, Stuart Organ. Abbott, Simon Cuff. And Dr. Stock, Stephen Hattersley. Other parts are played by members of the cast. Trent's Last Case was dramatized for radio by Alan Downer and directed by Jerry Jones.
Raffles, No Sinecure by E.W. Hornung. Bunny faces a grim future when his partner in crime Raffles is reported to have died. Crime thriller, starring Jeremy Clyde. From 1992.
Raffles by E.W. Hornung. A series of short stories dramatized for radio by Olwyn Wymark. With Jeremy Clyde as Raffles and Michael Cochrane as Bunny. No Sinecure.
Early morning in the Holloway Road. It was the year of the Diamond Jubilee, but I had little to celebrate. The sun was already forcing its way through the dirty windows of my cramped, untidy attic room. It was going to be a hot day. I sat at the rickety little table, the remains of my meagre breakfast pushed aside, trying to work. A series of articles being printed in a philanthropical daily. The subject, Reflections on Prison Life. My own.
Pull yourself together, man. At least you're alive.
Raffles was dead. A.J. Raffles, my dearest friend in the world and my partner in crime. That last image of him will be burned into my memory forever. We were on the German liner Vulcan between Genoa and Naples. Inspector Mackenzie of Scotland Yard, disguised, had followed us on board and arrested us. Then Raffles' sudden leap onto the ship's railing. I saw his hands shoot up and clasp together. Before anyone could move, the swift, plunging dive against the blazing sunset and into the sea below.
Your man has gone, Inspector.
One of them, aye. I might have known we'd never get him into a jail. He preferred the gentleman's way out.
What do you mean? He can swim?
I fear your friend has no hope, young man. We are a dozen miles from land. Currents around here are notorious.
Aye, they're muckle dangerous, it's said. Come away, Mr. Manders. We've seen the last of A.J. Raffles.
They took me and locked me in the brig. A small barred porthole looked out to sea. For many hours I watched while the ship hove to and boats were put out to search for my friend. As the sun sank behind the island of Elba...
Telegram for you.
What's that?
Telegram.
Oh, thanks.
I ain't had no rent off you this week, you know.
You'll get it.
See Mr. Maturin's advertisement daily. What? Ah, see Mr. Maturin's advertisement, Daily Mail. Might suit, beg, try, will speak if necessary. Not signed. Who on earth? Veer Street, May the 11th, 1897. God, Cousin Neville. But how could it be he? My eminent kinsman, complete with OBE, who not a month since had had me brutally turned out of his house when I had the temerity to call. I was a disgrace to the family. I'd made my bed, could go and live and die on it, etc., etc. And now? Prepared to speak for me for some kind of post?
I mustn't waste time. A wash, a quick shave, pawn shop for my suit. Oh, and buy a Daily Mail.
Third floor, sir.
Thank you.
No lift, I see.
Oh, come along. This is Earl's Court, not Mayfair.
Oh, sorry. Come about that job?
Yes.
You'll be lucky. I couldn't even get past the doctor.
Number 29, I presume?
I beg your pardon?
The 29th applicant today.
Is this Mr. Maturin?
Maturin. Yes. Come in.
Dr. Theobald, a man not much older than myself. Impeccable frock coat, high colour, moustache, a monocle.
Excellent. That's one of the public schools on his list of acceptables. He's not an easy man to please, and a colonial into the bargain. Believe me, if you get the billet, it'll be no sinecure. By the way, what's your name?
Manchester.
Through here, Mr. Manchester. So you think you could look after me, do you?
I'm certain I could, sir. Single-handed, mind.
I don't keep another soul. You'd have to cook your own grub, eh, my slops?
The reek of drugs and disinfectants was stifling. The room was darkened, but a chink from an ill-fitting blind glimmered on the gaunt, white face on the pillow.
Any experience?
Well...
Speak up, man. Done this kind of thing before?
No, sir.
Then what the devil makes you so certain you can do it now, eh?
I only meant I would do my best.
Done your best at everything else, then?
No, I have not.
You do well to own it. You do well, sir. Well, indeed. Not a varsity man, eh?
No.
What did you do when you left school?
I came into money.
And then?
I spent it.
And since then? Since then, I say?
A relative of mine will tell you if you ask him. He has promised to speak for me. I would rather say no more myself.
But you shall, sir. But you shall. A public schoolboy apply for a berth like this? Not unless something or other had dragged him down a bit. Think I'm a fool? Dr. Theobald?
Yes, Mr. Maturin, I'll show Mr. Manchester out.
No, confound you, show yourself out. Clear out, I said. This man may do or may not, but I don't need you here to make up my mind.
But...
Get out! Out! Out!
Yes, Mr. Maturin.
No sinecure indeed. Did I really want to be cooped up day and night with this hysterical despot?
And damn good riddance, eh? The man's a complete tyrant. I can't call myself my own. Watches me like a hawk, won't even let me smoke. You'll find the cigarettes tucked behind that very indifferent Rossetti print.
What? Yes, this one.
That's it.
Here you are.
Thanks. And now a light. Oh. Go on, take one yourself.
May I?
The porter smuggles them in for me. I've smoked worse.
But not like a Sullivan, eh, Bunny?
What did you say? Who are you?
Can't you guess?
It's impossible.
Oh, Bunny.
Raffles!
I cannot repeat what I said. I have no idea what I did. I only knew that it was A.J. Raffles in the flesh.
That was the very devil of a swim, Bunny. But I defy you or anybody else to sink in the Mediterranean. The sunset saved me. The sea was like a blazing fire and they couldn't spot me. Quite a long haul to Elba, though. There were moments, I don't mind admitting, when I thought I... Well, here I am now.
Oh, my dear chap, I can't believe it. It's like a... I must have a good look at you before we say another word.
Oh, have I changed so much then, Bunny?
Your hair, it's gone quite white. And just so thin. Raffles, you really are ill, aren't you?
Ill? Oh, my dear fellow, I'm dead. I'm at the bottom of the sea, and don't you forget it.
But surely...
Oh, yes, I realise there's a last-legged look about me. But that's from all this lying in bed in the dark, and being categorically forbidden solid food, and being half-poisoned by Theobald's blasted prescriptions.
But I don't understand. Why have a doctor at all if you're not ill? Why on earth lie in bed if you haven't got to?
Because it's a damn sight better than lying in jail. As you know only too well, my dear friend. Ah, Bunny, if you knew how often...
Oh, don't, AJ, please don't. Is he a quack, this Theobald fellow, and doesn't he guess that there's nothing wrong with you?
knows, bless you. But he doesn't know I know he knows. But I'm a fat income to him. He's going to marry on the profit he makes on me.
That telegram? You had something to do with it, didn't you?
No more than composing and sending it.
You old...
My memories of the stout cousin Neville still fit, eh?
Like a glove. But how did you find me?
Oh, I spotted you at once from those prison articles. Not signed, of course, but the fist was the fist of my sitting rabbit.
Yes, but who gave you my address?
Your editor. I visited his offices in the dead of night.
Huh?
Oh, yes, I occasionally go afield like other ghosts, you know. Yes, I wheedled it out of him in 5 minutes, knowing your name, you see. I, your only living relative, long lost, desperate to find you.
But why all the complication and subterfuge?
There are two of me now, Bunny. One's at the bottom of the Mediterranean, and one's an old Australian desirous of dying in the mother country. The only person he knows in London is his doctor. He's got to be consistent or he's done. Begin to see?
Yes, of course I do, AJ. I'm a fool. But, oh, what a devilish dull life for you.
Oh, not now you've come, my dear rabbit. Now then, back you go to your garret and get your things. How much will square you up there?
Tenner easily.
I had one ready for you. Oh, and get me a stall for the Lyceum tonight at the nearest agent's.
The Lyceum? But why?
For the good Dr. Theobald. When you come back, tell him someone gave it to you. And then, when he's out of the way, what say you to supper at Kellner's? The staff's all new there, I've discovered. We'll celebrate. This way, Bunny. We must get from our roof to the one next door, you see, over this little bridge. We have an excellent fire escape right down to the street. Most convenient for ghosts. Careful. Not too close to the parapet.
Oh, it's a sheer drop.
Hold on to this rail. That's it. And now, across to there. Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention we're from the Wild and Woolly West, so talk like a stage American.
What? I can't possibly.
Then keep mum and leave it to me. Hey, you!
May I help you, gentlemen?
You sure can. Take us up one of your little old private rooms. I made a reservation for it last night. Jumping, Jehoshaphat. Here, I'll pour that, friend. You just hustle right along. Bring us up our victuals.
Yes, sir.
I think I prefer your Australian.
Well, if you can do better.
No. Mm.
Paul Roger, 84. It's a long time since you and I cracked a bottle of this.
A long time, Raffles. A long, long time.
Well, here's to now. The old team, back to work.
When you say back to work, Raffles...
Mm, well, the work that you and I know best, Bunny. What else?
Crime, you mean?
I prefer to think of it as adventure.
Yes, you always did.
Bunny, I must have the straight truth from you. Are you game?
Yes. Yes, I am.
Good man.
6 months ago, I'd have said no. I swear I've done my honest best since my reappearance in the world, Raffles, but the world seems determined to do its worst by me. So, lead on the dance.
Well said. Well, gee willikers, didn't I tell you?
Your Chateau Margaux, sir.
Can you beat it? I had an aunt called Margaux. Put her down there, son. My partner here was saying this is one humdinger of a meal. Ain't that right, partner?
What? Yes, dang tootin'.
Very kind, son.
Have a care, Bunny. I don't want you tripping over that parapet into eternity.
Don't worry about me, old chap. Nothing to it.
I've got you. Here. Let's sit down for a last cigarette. Oh, no lights on in the ground floor, so our medico's still out.
We smoked in companionable silence up there between the chimney stacks and the stars. Full of good food and excellent wine, reunited with the dearest friend I had, who until today I thought I'd lost forever, I felt a golden glow of contentment. I was quite startled when he broke the silence.
Gold.
Huh? What's that?
Gold. That's what we need. Gold can be melted down into nuggets and paid for in hard cash across the counter in the Bank of England.
Yes, that's true.
Jewelry's simply not worth the effort. Do you remember that first little crib we cracked together? A couple of thousand that stuff was worth. Easily. A few hundreds is what we got. No, by God, I'm done with fences forever.
Me too.
Heard of the Room of Gold at the British Museum?
Hmm? No, I can't say I... What? British Museum? You don't mean you'd...
Free admission, Bunny. Good deal simpler than drain pipes and rope ladders.
That just may be, but the place is alive.
That room is positively stuffed with gold. Old vases and ewers and coins, and there's one really exquisite piece. A gold cup worth thousands.
Oh, Raffles, be reasonable. I mean, surely even you aren't getting...
What's that? What's the good doctor? Now, quick, Bunny. Move like the wind, down those back stairs and into our beds before he gets up there for his late-night checkup.
What? Who's that? Answer me. Who's that sneaking in here?
Only me, Mr. Maturin.
Only? Do you want me to have heart failure? Is that what you're after, you damn fool?
Now, you know I always look in last thing.
There's no more need for that. This fellow Manchester's bunked down in the corner. Are you there, Manchester? Hey.
I'm here.
Sir, I'm here, sir.
I'm here, sir.
As for you, Theobald, don't I have enough trouble sleeping without you skulking about?
Yes, but...
He'll come and get you if you're needed, which you won't be.
Ah, you can't be too sure of
a satisfaction. Have I ever needed you at night? Not once, never. So get back down to your own quarters and stay there.
Well, if you're really...
Now!
Yes. Good night, Mr. Maturin.
You know, I do believe you enjoy all that ranting, AJ.
Oh, thoroughly. It's frightfully cathartic. It only makes him congratulate himself on restoring my energy. Up you get. We've got to get out of these duds.
Lucky he didn't switch on the light. I've still got my hat on.
The matrimonial knot gets tied next week and he'll be off on his honeymoon. Now, the day after he goes, you can bribe the porter and tell him I'm pining for fresh air. We'll hire one of those invalid carrying chairs from Harrods to get me down the stairs.
Where are we going?
Kew Gardens.
Oh, right, eh?
And then we'll double back to the British Museum.
Now, Raffles...
Just for a reconnoitre, Bunny. What do you say?
Well, as long as that's all it is.
Steady as you go, sir. Lift your end for the turn.
Yes,
all right. Confound it, you're jostling me. I won't be jostled.
Well, that's all right, sir. Don't you upset yourself. Here we are. Now then... You take his other arm, sir. Yes. Out we get. Into the cab.
Watch what you're doing.
I'm trying to.
Easy does it, sir. Well, there we are. Now, will you be taking this contraption with you, Mr. Manchester?
Huh? Oh, yes, I suppose we will.
No, we won't. They've got bath chairs for hire at Kew. Use your head, man.
Sorry, sir.
Well, I'll stow it in the hall then, sir. You've got a lovely hot day for your outing.
Put the bath chair over by that bench, Bunny.
Righto.
And now, quick march out the other entrance. We want to get there when the museum opens, before the crowds. Tuppenny guide, please.
There we are, sir.
Thank you. Now, let's see. Ah, yes, here it is. Room 43.
How do we know we won't see anybody who'll recognize us?
Have we ever known anybody who'd be in the British Museum at 10 in the morning? Come on, up those stairs.
I was frankly disappointed in the so-called Room of Gold. We were quite obviously wasting our time. Nothing I saw in the glass cases looked anything but dilapidated and flimsy. And the biggest fraud of all was the very cup Raffles had mentioned.
Why, it's as thin as paper.
Quite. Hardly worth all this trouble to come and look at it. Shall we go?
Oh, what a philistine you are, Bunny. By Jove, it's magnificent. What do you think? Could we lift it?
You better hadn't try, sir.
Good God! How could we have missed sighting this portly, red-faced constable?
Well, I'm very glad to see they've got a proper policeman to guard it. Going to run me in, officer?
I didn't say I was, sir. But that's a queer way for a gentleman like yourself to be talking.
Well, for saying to my friend that I should like to run off with the gold cup? Why, I don't mind who hears me say it, officer. It's one of the most beautiful things I ever saw in my life.
Well, I dare say there's a good many as feels like that, sir.
Exactly. But seriously, officer, is something as valuable as this quite safe in a case like that?
Safe enough as long as I'm here.
But you appear to be single-handed. Is that wise?
I'm not single-handed. See that seat by the door? One of the attendants sits there all day long.
Well, where is he now, pray?
Only just down the corridor.
A national treasure ought to be guarded better than this. Why, you haven't even got a truncheon. Now, I shall write to the Times about this.
Lord bless you, sir, I'm all right. This here room would be filled up with people in no time. And there's safety in numbers, they say.
Oh, it'll fill up soon, will it?
Another 10 minutes at the most, sir. We don't usually get them up here till about 1:30. It's all them stairs.
Well, I shall write to the Times all the same. You say the attendant's just outside, but it sounds to me as though he's at the other end of the corridor.
He cocked his head, and for a moment we all three listened. We could just hear the murmur of voices, but a good distance off. Raffles' public-spirited indignation was visibly increasing.
No, it won't do. It really won't do. What if my friend and I actually were professional thieves? Why, we could overpower you in an instant.
That you couldn't.
Oh, you think not? Well, perhaps I can persuade you differently.
What have you done?
Knocked him out, I hope. Quick, run to the door, see if those attendants are coming.
Mechanically, I obeyed him. But even in my bewilderment, the instinctive caution of the real criminal did not desert me. I ran to the door, but sauntered out into the corridor. I planted myself in front of a Pompeian fresco. There were the two attendants still gossiping at the end of the corridor. It was hot weather, but the perspiration on my body seemed to have turned into a skin of ice. It was only when Raffles strolled out to join me that anger brought me back to life. A single glance showed me he was completely empty-handed. This wanton, reckless act had been for nothing.
Interesting collection, but nothing to what they have in the museum in Naples. Shall we go?
He took my arm and, cool as you please, moved off in the very direction of the two attendants.
Slow march, Bunny. The fat constable hasn't moved an eyelid. I hope he's still alive, but we don't want to swing for him by showing indecent haste.
You think we'd be getting all the foreigners? I mean, London's crawling with them, but I ain't never seen...
Excuse me.
Oh. Yes, sir?
A prehistoric art?
Down the stairs and round to your left, sir.
Thanks so much.
I believe you're mad.
Steady, Bunny, for God's sake. It's slow march for our lives. And pray for a cab when we get out of here.
It wasn't until we got rid of the porter and were alone in his apartment that I told Raffles frankly and exactly what I thought of this latest deed. He stood my abuse without a murmur, too astounded even to take off his hat.
It has always been your infernal way. You make one plan for yourself, tell me another just to keep me quiet, and then you...
Not today, Bunny, I swear.
You said reconnoiter.
Absolutely my only intention.
Then why go and do what you did? Why on earth risk being run in for nothing?
I should have deserved running in if I hadn't yielded to that temptation, Bunny.
Oh,
what a chance in 100,000. We might go there every day of our lives and never again be the only outsiders in that room with one guard and the other side of earshot. It was a gift from the gods. Not to have taken it would have been flying in the face of Providence.
But you didn't take it. You went and left it behind.
Bunny.
I had seen that little smile with which Raffles now shook his head once or twice in the past. All this time he had been wearing...
Your hat.
My hat, Bunny. And our cup.
For 10 days that confounded gold cup sat on the chimneypiece to be adored by Raffles, while newspaper columns were filled with shock stories about its fate. Once we had learned that our constable had only been stunned, Raffles' spirits rose to new heights.
Look at it. Only look at it, man. Was ever anything so rich and yet so delicate? Oh, and the history of the thing. Do you realize it's 500 years old? It once belonged to Henry VIII.
What I realize is that it represents considerable danger for us both being here at all, and that the gold in it would scarcely pour 3 figures out of the melting pot.
Good God, Bunny, what are you suggesting? Taking it was an offense against the law, but destroying it would be a crime against God and art. When you have me cremated, you can put my ashes in that cup and have us buried together.
And meanwhile?
Meanwhile, it's the joy of my heart and the delight of mine eye.
And suppose other eyes catch sight of it?
Oh, they never must. They never shall.
It was quite bootless talking to him in this mood. I continued sending off my weekly telegram of report to Dr. Theobald as ordered, the composition of which gave Raffles much pleasure.
And I must regretfully report that Mr. Maturin's temper grows worse daily. This week alone, he is shattered... Several soup plates, two thermometers, and a pudding bowl. By the way, Bunny, I've had an idea after your own heart. I know now where I can place the cup.
Then I congratulate you.
Thank you.
On the recovery of your senses.
You've been so confoundedly unsympathetic about this thing, Bunny, that I don't think I shall tell you my scheme.
I assure you, I haven't the least wish to know it.
However, it will mean you're occupying the porter this very afternoon.
Huh?
Twice. Once when I go out, and once about an hour and a half later when I return.
This afternoon?
Yes. Tomorrow's Sunday, and the Jubilee's on Tuesday, and Theobald's coming back for it.
But why not go after dark?
Because it must be before six. One more thing.
Yes?
Will you go out immediately and buy me a tin of Huntley and Palmer biscuits?
Biscuits?
Biscuits. The largest tin they have, mind.
Obviously, I was to be treated like a child. I quietly carried out my ludicrous errand, and then at 4:30 engaged the attention of the porter as instructed. That night, the cup was gone.
Don't you want to know how much I got for it, Bunny?
Not really, no.
Nothing. Not a crimson cent.
I never thought it had a market value. I told you so in the beginning.
As a matter of fact, I had to pay them to take it.
Oh, doesn't surprise me in the least. And that was the last mention we made of the subject until Monday morning, when Dr. Theobald returned.
Have you seen this in the paper, Mr. Maturin?
I don't know, do I, till you tell me what it is?
It's about that gold cup that was stolen from the British Museum.
Yes? What about it?
They've got it back.
What are you talking about, got it back? A Scotland Yard, you mean? But how?
Hang on there, Manchester. Just calm down. He's wild about antiques, this fella. Uh-huh. Been worried sick about that cup. What's the story, Doctor?
It was posted to Park Lane, to the Queen's equerry, Sir Arthur Bigg, in a biscuit tin.
Good God.
Quite. It had a note in it from the audacious villain who'd taken it.
A note?
Printed on a postcard. It just said, let's see, with the loyal respects of the thief for Her Majesty on her diamond jubilee.
Well, I'll be damned.
What the devil's up with you, Manchester? You find that funny, do you?
Yes, I do. What a sportsman.
Sportsman? A common thief?
Well, not all that common. Sir?
I entirely agree with you, Mr. Maturin. The man's nothing but a flashy blackguard. In my view...
When I want your views, I'll ask for them.
Yes, Mr. Maturin.
That evening, I went out to a tobacconist and smuggled in a box of Sullivan's. We filled our glasses with the whiskey, which was concealed by day under my mattress, and lit up our cigarettes.
The Queen.
The Queen.
God bless her.
In No Sinecure by E.W. Hornung, dramatised for radio by Alwyn Weimark, Jeremy Clyde was A.J. Raffles, and Michael Cochrane, Barney Manders. Gordon Reed played Dr. Theobald, John Hartley, Mr. Maturin, John Church, the Constable, Keith Drinkle, the Landlord, and John Webb, the Porter. Other parts were played by Henry Stamper, Frederick Yeager, and members of the cast. The Raffles theme music was composed by Jim Parker, the sound balance was by Keith Perrin, and the production was by Gordon House.